Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Sonic League show with your host, Sean Bond. And today we have a magnificent guest known as Douglas Dietrich. He is a scholar and he used to work for the military document disposal aspect for the Presidial military base.
Yes.
And he is well versed in the cult and secret knowledge and hidden truths in the history that has been destroyed by bureaucracy and replaced with false truths to paint a picture of like oh it's all sunny and just trust us kind of thing. He's now bringing that out and like kind of a whistleblowing it, but like, you know, in a more expanded way, because he is also fairly photographic in his memory. And he brings out such gifts and knowledge to this world. Thank you, and show your love in the comments. Can you add a little bit more to that introduction?
Yeah, sure. Definitely. And I want to thank you. That introduction is very gracious and it's very graceful. I think that we can do is just kind of go along organically with everything. Obviously, document disposal is a little bit less dignified than document destruction. But I will say this much. I worked the incinerator at the Presidio. I'm sorry?
Incineration is
yes. I worked the incinerator at the Presidio military base and destroyed an enormous number of documents. Our man, Mr. Sean Bond, says that I have a fairly photographic memory because I did a lot to destroy that photographic memory as much as possible in order to, well, it's not a gift, it's a curse, and it really contributes symptomatically to complex post-traumatic stress disorder. So one of the things that helped me, of course, was my psychiatrist, Dr. Tao Tran, who was magnificent in terms of using highly advanced regressive and also, in a sense, suggestive hypnotherapy. There was a lot of deep hypnosis that was conducted so that I could compartmentalize a lot of the experiences that were providing me particular pain. And along with that, and a lot of basically narcotization, a lot of drinking and drug abuse, I've managed to do some damage quite intentionally to my once photographic memory. However, that being said, I noticed that there's this protective gesture. I take that as almost a healing gesture. I take it protective and compassionate. And at any rate, that having been done, I still remember quite a bit. And we'll go into those memories, not necessarily of all the painful things that happened at the Presidio or otherwise in my life, but certainly we'll talk about basically my trying to overcome cultural genocide, which is what documents destruction really is. It's a form of cultural genocide. And we'll do that today by going into some fairly deep topics, dark topics, or at least topics that get dismissed quite a bit. With that having been said, I'm going to let Mr. Sean Bond take over again.
Sure. Yeah, and warning to people in the Love and Light community, if you're easily triggered and not very able to handle dark topics and dark truths easily, this show might not be for you. Though if you're wanting to be brave in doing this, go ahead and hug yourself and cultivate love and loving detachment to a lot of these subjects, because they are quite overwhelming. And hug it and transmute it down and get to release the fear, because fear holds us back, and this kind of stuff needs to be brought out to the world, because it's how we stop more suffering from existing. Dark truths is like, there's a parasite on you. And then there's like, what are you talking about? I don't believe in parasites. And Once a person can accept that dark truth is real, and they can move past and they can do the thing that it takes to resolve it so that they don't suffer, and they can remove that out of this reality, making it better. So not saying that we can do that in general for all the things we're going to be bringing that up, but we can at least work towards that in like some interesting psychological back and forth. And
yes.
So in my background, I used to be very skeptical of a lot of this stuff, and then a huge amount of spiritual stuff happened to me that threw me into having the option to not believe it, with demons and forced possession, and then learning how to depossess myself and also depossess others, and healing and healing pain and releasing over a distance, and resolving targeted individuals and a lot of other stuff, tracking back DNA. So I came across these things that we're going to talk about, such as vampirism. And it was interesting at the time, and I kept getting more data on it when I tracked back in the DNA. And it kind of, I got stopped a little bit from being public about it because I didn't want to create fear about it. And I wasn't, I'm not like an arbiter of truth. So I don't want to, make something that will bring more fear or whatever. Because I don't particularly believe that just because we believe something, it's going to manifest that. It like takes the whole collective and a lot of other stuff in the background that is happening. But we have a really grounded perspective here in reality and history. So maybe he can help bring a lot of this awareness to grounding. And I'm not trying to project anything. So, let me know what you think on any of the things I also bring up in our back and forth.
I'm sorry. Cool. I'm so sorry.
So I tracked back that a fair 10% of people have recessant genes for vampirism that have been inherited a long time ago, usually around something around the fall of what our old civilization would be, around Atlantis or something. There seems to be a bunch of invading forces that came in around that time that introduced a lot of dark programming into our genetics and from multiple different places. And it's got an interesting history thing, including from other realms. And I liked in your book that, the screen. Let's see. Let me just product place this a little bit. Okay. VAMPHYROLOGY. So Vampirology by Douglas Dietrich. Totally get it. It's really good. Well compiled awareness of this topic for those out there. He says he's going to make more.
Thank you.
So feel free to correct me, and you don't have to hold anything, hold this on shelves and stuff. I'm willing to I read there's the reason I tapped into this, because I was trying to figure out what were the things that were upending the balance system of Earth why it's a pain in the ass to live here, why we're here in the first place, a lot of people incarnating to make this place better, all that. So I read that the system of death has been uprooted and unbalanced, why do the good die young kind of thing? Why can't you earn life extension in a positive way by making this world a better place? Why is the dark stealing a lot of authority for this? And I found that they are through a bunch of invasions. They stole a bunch of authority and devoured a bunch of authority holders and founding species, all this kind of stuff. The death authority is interesting because when I was reading what causes death, it seems like there's a buildup of a type of energy when a person's about to die that I just call death energy. And the dark system likes to summon demons do deals with them to get this death energy that they're naturally producing if they're doing really dark things to where they need to be rejected or ejected from this game. And they're putting that onto the populace to get it off of them, and including sickness and suffering and other types of things that would be accumulated in natural law. So there's these things that are distributing their suffering to those that don't deserve it, and targeting powerful people like yourself and me that want to make this world a better place, and is putting it onto them to stop us. And so there's like a natural system of death that can be brought back to balance. And if it is, then so I read like a few different things that were upending that, including vampires. I read that there are different types. You can call them a bunch of different things, but based on the DNA lineages I've tracked back, and I read them all down for a while ago, 10 types of life extension, types of vampire kind of things. The sanguine blood ones that you talk about, the regular people that take adrenochrome, these cannibal ones that are like, it's like giants. Vampires, life force vampires, and there's these five different evolutionary branches of soul eating vampires. And then I read like 60 plus other types of energy stealing parasitic DNA lineages that are passed down to human, but they don't get extension from in life by stealing these things. They just get overpowered in that type of energy. What can you tell us about since writing this book, what do you believe in the origin of these type of beings are?
Well, there's so many that you brought up that would
yes,
be
sorry, a lot.
That would essentially be part of the story of the cosmos. I appreciate. First off, let's start off with some qualifiers, as our man Sean Bond did. Sean Bond was giving kind of a forewarning to anybody who is hypersensitive to that which is dark and negative, and of course he also qualified the fact that I am very grounded myself, and I have to deal with a lot of the visceral reality of hostility that's engendered by the fact that what I reveal is dark and negative. So do understand, if you're in the chat room and are in the comments and you want to show your love, that's wonderful. And do communicate with Mr. Bond if we do get the inevitable, which is going to be the gang stalkers and the trolls. And these are the cultists of the Kings of Edom, the very dark and anti-natural entities that are not part of this universe. And in a sense, that leads us in to try and explain the cosmology in which Mr. Sean Bond works, the reality that he had to contend with, what almost overwhelmed himself and drew him into a very dark place until he encountered the dragon spirit and my very surname. Dietrich, of course, is the Germanic word for Dietrich, the dragon. And that, of course, is very similar to the knighted title of Ladislav Sepish, which was Dietrich, or Dracula is a Romanization of it, but it is actually Dietrachula, which simply meant son of the dragon. That was because his father was a sworn knight of the Order of the Dragon, and his father's title was simply Dietrich, or Dracul, in the Slavicization of that that name. And so there are many ways to speak that name. Ultimately, it's my surname, and it's a surname that I inherited from the man who raised and guided myself. When it comes to this kind of negativity, confront the fact that if there are gang stalkers and there's trolls in the commentary or the chat, bring them to the attention of Mr. Bond. It will be entirely per his discretion, but honestly, I would say it would be best to simply eliminate those people, because what they do is they leave comments that simply confuse people, they distract people, and they are part of the agenda of chaos and confusion. And ultimately, this is what the anti-gods of the cultists are attempting to sow in this universe. Understand that your universe is a creation that is based on a natural order. And the best way that you can diagrammatically describe this is, as I have done in detail, through HaKabbalah. And that was gifted us many centuries ago, millennia ago, essentially, by the Judaic culture. And the Kabbalah shows the Tree of Life. And then it centers on Earth and goes into the Tree of Death, which is the mirror image of that tree. But in the center of it all, between the Tree of Life and Death, is Malkuth, the material world, our world. And this is where all the action is. And our world, despite people often denigrating it as material, as if that's a negative, the reality that all of the heavens and all of the hells, the Sephiroth and the Klipoth, they center on this world and have no meaning without this world. They exist so that this world exists, hence the very order of creation. Where these anti-gods come from is not from this Tree of Life or Death. They are not even Klipothic. Klipothic would imply demons and devils, and there is a difference. And of course, it must be understood that all of that is part of the natural order. Even though the Tree of Life represents that which comes out of the earth, the Malkuth, the material world, or our material universe, and the Sephiroth ascend towards the ever finer radiances of the heavens. When we go into the lower vibrations, that extestinal tract of the husks or shells of the Klipoth, those sewers of Seth, those sewers of the devils and demons and the damned, they're absolutely necessary for this cosmic ecosystem to function. Our man Sean Bond brought up, of course, bad things happening to good people, essentially, when he's talking about why do the good die young? Why is it that some people can strive and work and uphold the law and maintain a sense of ethical integrity and never get anywhere, or essentially seem to be punished for it? And whereas other people do what is ill and seem to prosper, seem to thrive, or even be honored and respected for what they do. Aside from other rationalizations such as kalpas and different ages in which this is possible in either the Buddhistic or the Vedic sense, there is simply that eternal cosm sense of the Sephiroth and the Klipoth, the higher and lower vibrations, where all of this is necessary for our universe to work. In other words, understand that for all that you like to see above the ground, those wonderful flowers in your garden, all of the blossoms, all of the that which is above ground that you appreciate in terms of growth, even that which you ultimately eat, the food that you harvest, the grain. Beneath all of that is a seething compost pile of carrion, and it's based on the fecal matter of animals and humans, and oftentimes manure is necessary for the growth of entire harvests that feed humankind. So without that shit, without all of those composting creatures, whether they be worms or that which is far more malignant in nature, that which is above the ground would not be produced. So think of those devils and demons and all the ill that they do as a natural part of the process of what is good in your world. All of this ultimately sources from the divine. That which is evil, which rises up to claim you and pull you under, that is divine. All of this is divine. And understand that just because I'm saying what I say to put devils and demons in their ecosystemic perspective, their context of what they do by being bad is ultimately good. Understand that doesn't make it any safer to play with them. If you were to go outside in some field of manure or say, for instance, in a poor nation like North Korea, where they still use night soil, human fecal matter in their attempt to raise a harvest. And this results, of course, in the price they pay for that. North Korean escapees, people who have managed to escape. They've been found with very long intestinal worms inside of them. Whenever they manage to break into South Korea, the first thing the South Koreans must do is deworm them and make certain that they can free them of what they've gained from the North Korean diet. If you were to go out and into a playground in a urban setting where people are regularly taking their dogs to shit, and the children are let loose in there and they're playing around these playgrounds and they're exposed to this, they can get ringworm at the very least, or diseases serious enough to render them blind. You don't want to be playing with this sort of thing. So just because devils and demons are doing good in the ultimate sense, it doesn't mean that they're your friend in the intimate sense or in the immediate sense. They are dangerous. They are dirty. They are, however, a necessary part of the ecosystem. And once you understand that and all the ills that befall good people, all of this is the Book of Job. All of this is the divine corrupting people and people who are good. There needs to be an amount of them that fall by the wayside, that ultimately get corrupted, because this is what feeds the legions of the damned that ultimately are the compost that, and the carrion that help us thrive in the material world through the ecosystem of the creation. And there's always opportunity in those netherworlds, those lower regions, for redemption, because ultimately it's all recycled. Just as the compost and the carrion die and the blossoms that are produced are comprised of their organic matter, ultimately, or at least their organic matter provides the nutrients, therefore, so too the damned ultimately recycle, and at some point, which must feel like an eternity to them, they ascend, and that which is ascended also lowers, oftentimes first by materializing, becoming part of the material world, and then ultimately incarnating in the bodily form. And the one thing I can tell you, as a person who's died multiple times, I've suffered clinical deaths many a time in my life, and I've been dead more than once. And I can tell you, from having seen both of those vibratory levels of existence, that the afterlife in many ways, certainly even if we think of the higher realms, is not necessarily all it's cracked up to be from your perspective as a human being. In other words, it can get very boring to be in a state of eternal bliss or peace. This is why souls reincarnate. There are people in heaven who cannot wait to reincarnate. They want to come back here because being eternally in Summerland, as the spiritists used to call it back in the day, the man who raised and guided me, Chief Petty Officer of the United States Navy, George Joseph Henry Dietrich, he was a man who was born in upstate New York. That's where originally the movement of spiritism started. And these were people who were trying to communicate with the dead. And this was because so many people in World War I lost their children. And it was after World War I that people said, oh my God, so many people had lost so many children, that the movement of spiritism was born, in which they tried seances to communicate with their lost children. And these people who were attempting that, it was the birth of a new religion. There's still a town in upstate New York where the majority of people are spiritists, practicing spiritists. And the reason I bring that up is not so that you join them or feel a need to, I need to check into this, I want to find out about that. But, you know, all that's fine if you want to investigate that. Understand that I've also heard people having negative experiences, because if you try to talk with the dead too much, well, they come into you. And why? Because nothing beats being alive. Nothing really beats being able to physically move yourself, eat, have sex, even void your bowels. It's, these things are considered, these are missed. These experiences are missed by people on the other side, believe me. So there are plenty of people on the other side, even at the higher vibratory levels, who can't wait to get back here and incarnate again. So you just understand that it's and for people in the nether regions, it's not necessarily even punishments that are the worst. It's actually missing what you had. The missing what you were able to experience, that can be the worst that's down there. Perhaps even worse than whatever discomforts might be felt at the lower vibratory level. So hopefully that puts this into perspective, because when we think of the anti-gods, of the cultists who ceaselessly attack myself, whether it be in the chat or in the comment section, understand that they are not of this natural tree of life and death. These are people who worship the anti-gods that are extra-dimensional, extra-stellar, extra-cosmic. They are outside of God's creation. These anti-gods are of what is called Rasha, the tree of anti-life, the antimatter universe. And so these are the gods of the failed cosmos prior our perfect creation. And even the devils and demons of our world would stand against them. Understand that. And in that sense, the devils and the demons truly are your friend, your ally. They count on one thing for their existence: you. Without your greed, without your sin, without your lust, without your vile, depraved predations that evolve in so many human beings, the devils and demons of the lower nether worlds, the husks of the Klepoth, would not exist. So ultimately, they would protect you from those anti-gods of the tree of beyond death, the anti-life tree of Rasha. And so this is what needs to be understood in terms of the cosmos that I've learned to deal with. I received a theological education the wrong way, in the same way I received a medical education the wrong way. Received a medical education the wrong way by being a care provider and advocate for my parents in their declining years for over 11 years. And during that 11-year period, I saw it all. When I, of course, earlier before that, was working with the Dr. Colonel Michael Aquino. He, of course, was practicing Satanist originally, and later on became something far worse, an Edomite, a cultist of the anti-gods. If anyone wonders at the nature of the anti-gods, a hint and nothing more, a flake, a hint, an illusion is provided by Howard Phillips Lovecraft when he speaks of Cthulhu and that pantheon. Those are the anti-gods of Edom. That is a pulp shadow of them, but it is all theologically true. It is mentioned in the Quran that Cthulhu is the great forsaker. Shaitan is Al-Cthulhu, the abandoner. Understand that this is quite real, has been recognized by theologies and cosmologies and mythologies for aeons before recorded history. And their cults are alive. And more than anyone else, they seek to character assassinate myself. If they can assassinate my character, they hope that no one will listen to me. Understand what Howard Phillips Lovecraft himself said when he spoke in The Shadow Over Innsmouth. That's his longest writ, the only work published in his lifetime while he was alive, that was in book form. He had short stories that were published in his lifetime, but that was the only novella published in hard print as a book, hard copy as a book, hardback cover, that was released. And The Shadow Over Innsmouth, within that writ, that novella, Howard Phillips Lovecraft says that elder sign, which holds the anti-gods away, which the only sign which wards them, is... That's correct. The Hakenkreuz, the hooked cross, what his character says, what you would call a swastika nowadays. So Zadok is the name of the character that says that. And understand that this is why the Hakenkreuz is so heated and why there is a mass movement to eliminate it from appearing anywhere. Because that way you are left without that ward. You are left without that ability to hold the anti-gods away. That is the depth of the conspiracy. It is immense, and it has been here for thousands of years, and they're way ahead of you, and they seek the ultimate destruction of all life in the universe. This is the true enemy. And when it comes to that, what we need to begin to understand about these populations that our man Sean Bond has brought up, you know, these parasitic ones here, these ones are kind of like cannibals, and these ones kind of like, you know, they exsanguinate you, you know, suck your blood dry. Then there's these other ones that are kind of like, you know, psychic in nature. And, you know, well, basically what we need to begin to do is disambiguate those that are part of this natural ecosystem and part of this cosmic order of being, and those that are unnatural, those that are part of the servitor races of the anti-gods that are simply entropic. So to put it in the further analogy, for those who understood the parallel so far, of that which is below the ground, that you need all the ugliness down there, all the shit, the decaying matter, including carcasses and cadavers that are fed off by the gnats and the mealyworms and all of these other grotesque critters that you would never want to find on yourself when you wake up in the morning, or worse yet, inside yourself. All of these things are necessary for that growth of that which is beautiful that you eat or that you appreciate for its aesthetics, such as blossoms. You've got that. Now that you've got that part, how are the anti-gods analogous? They are like industrial effluvia. We're talking about industrial-grade toxic waste that's not part of nature. It does nothing to add to the ecosystem. It can only destroy it or mutate it into hideous, toxic malformations that do no good for the environment and do no good for you. That is the cult of the kings of Edom. That is the cult of the anti-gods. And that is what we must contend with as the ultimate enemy. My enemy is your enemy. And understand that, because the attacks on myself will come, as they do with every episode. They will come in the chat. They will come in the commentary. And it's your discernment that will save you. Now, understand, this isn't a question of damnation or salvation. This isn't a question of, I'm here to help you save your soul. What it is a question of is a total annihilation. If you are damned, as opposed to blessed or ascended, you're still a lucky human soul, because the damned serve a purpose. The damned are in this cosmos for a reason. And of course, there is always the recycling, the redemption that will take place through the eons, or what will feel like eternity to yourself. But if you become a servant of the anti-gods, all that awaits is annihilation of yourself. The nullity is what the cultists seek, a total annihilation, which they feel is an escape from the wheel of samsara. This is a misunderstanding of what someone like a Buddhist would strive for, which is to ascend from the wheel of samsara, to sever themselves from the suffering. And in the end, one thing you might notice is that these Buddhas, the people who do attain enlightenment and do become a bodhisattva, Like a Roman Catholic saint, in the end, they always come back here to help others. So you're never really escaping, are you? You may be above the pettiness. You may be above the sticks and stones or the words hurled against you. But the majority of the Buddhas are either prayed to, and then in a sense, intervene indirectly, or they return to the material world to do what they can to help the rest of mankind strive for betterness. So like a Roman Catholic saint, they're always watching over us. No one who's in this system ever really leaves. And that's fine. The system was created to persevere. But there are those who seek its destruction, and they feel that through that, they attain godhood. That if they can destroy the creation, then they are as unto gods. And hence, they serve the anti-gods. These are the worst of the worst. Understand your enemy. Now, who are your allies? There are more than you know of, because you are in a matrix where you feel that humanity is the only species left alive in terms of Homo sapiens, that other hominids, that other humanoid races such as Neanderthalus, Homo Neanderthalus, Cro-Magnon man. So many of these primitive peoples, the recently discovered, comparatively recently discovered, dragon man, all of these various subspeciations, Homo floresiensis, the scientific hobbit, all of these subspeciations of humanity once existed side by side with people just like you and I. Or rather, because I'm not really like you, I'm not really fully baseline human, being somewhat vampiroid myself, 1/4, which we could go into, more like Sean Bond and yourself. But when it comes to who you relate to, you are essentially someone who would relate more to these extinct humans than you would to, say, the ghoul or various other subspeciations of really anthropoid species. They are human-like. And yes. So go on. Were you going to say something, Sean? Did you want to provide some input there?
Oh, I have a lot with everything you're saying, but I love your flow, so I feel bad breaking it.
Oh, go ahead. But, please.
Okay. Yeah, I agree with everything you're saying, because, like, I mean, in the beginning, I was, like, a little distraught from it and, like, afraid of the dark, but now I'm, like, oh, because I was integrating a lot of it, and it's good to do shadow work, otherwise you can't grow in it, as it makes you resilient, and everyone that's a human is, like, an angel and demon combined together, plus, like, a whole bunch of other species combined in our DNA record and a lot of other stuff. So we're like this super hybrid experiment that is beyond what most species here is viewing us as, because they only get a little piece of the puzzle, and even then it's like infinite potential. But yeah, and I knew you had some vamp DNA in you too, so that was cool to get confirmation. Yeah, and I also agree with your cosmology aspect with the Tree of Life, and I've tracked back that, yeah, that's true with the realms overlaid with each other in one, like Sephiroth, for the body and the fruit, and the also the ones for the earth as being her making a bunch of realms, the nine main realms of Yggdrasil, plus the heavenly realms, the quarantine realms and hell realms. I have actually a lot of experience with them. I was one time thrown into a hell realm for like compressed time for like thousands of years, and it was torture, but I wouldn't wish that on my worst enemy. But I learned a fuck ton, and I had all that brought back with me very quickly, and it propelled me on my healing path quite a bit. So I learned a whole everything they used against me. There's big predators in that hell realm.
Yes.
So I had to learn while they were fracturing me apart and all that. I had to learn how to outperform them and eventually get my parts back. But everything that they threw at me, I learned, including the temporal imprisoned realm tech, how to manage prison realms, and then there's this cool thing to it, because like Earth, She has a, so like all these planets also have consciousness. They're making a whole bunch of realms to individually put different types of forms of life in each realm. And because they can't all just interact with each other, and they have different rules, and some of them are vacation realms. This is not a vacation realm, and then have different purposes. The quarantine realms are not always meant to be like a hellish or a quarantine realm, but get invaded to the point where it has to become that, and then they quarantine all a bunch of negative species that are invading there because Earth, as an example, sees value in them and wants to graduate them through a process. Sometimes the hell realm gets sped up kind of like a Narnia thing compared to the frame of time with this realm. And so they get graduated fast, and then they run through to other realms, and they go up the lava lamp of light and dark. So it's absolutely beautiful in how the system works. And any demon that comes at me, because they come all the time and I have to remove them off people, they're fractured beings. They're abused. They aren't whole. They can't create their own light. They either way, they forgot how, or they never knew how. Their heart's been shut down. I learned all the different systems of tech to bringing back their. Oh, this is how I do it. Like as soon as they come, you'll feel that most people that don't know that these exist, they will experience it as like big heart pressures, like drain of energy. The demons don't give a shit that you believe they exist. It doesn't matter at all. They want you to not believe they exist so they can just drain off you. So yes. They'll be draining off them, causing pain, headaches, anxiety, stress, fear. Like you'll get nightmares and visions and all this kind of other stuff, depending on the influence they want. And then they'll add to the person's shadow, making them obnoxious or a bad person. And then like building that up as a harvesting thing, or they could drive a person to suicide, which is unfortunate. There's all kinds of demons, but they're much better than the anti-gods. And I agree with you that I'd love to talk with you. I'm going to absolutely do that. This is how I treat them. So like anything that builds up on a person's heart wall, let's make it simple. Your goal is to make this flame in your heart that gets brighter, that will be like a compassionate, loving flame that encompasses, engulfs every one of those heart walls that builds up. The heart wall is like, just imagine the time you've been the most happy and expanded in your life compared to any point that you are now. That's the difference. That's the heart wall. Those heart walls will be based on trauma, trapped emotions, attachments, entity attachment, limitation, all this kind of stuff. It'll go back to a consciousness. I get up under it with loving detachment first, like pulses from the heart with each heartbeat. First, you want a loving detachment from it, but with like care and treating it kind of like a baby bird. These demons are younger than most of the humans here. In whatever soul origin you want to go into, but you know, not everyone. Some of them are really ancient, but like you, as an example, are more ancient. So you can like see them as like children of the universe, and you can get up under with love and detachment, and like I do this bubble of no time that speeds up things, gets their wholeness back, remembering who they are, that I'm ultimately them. Stop harming yourself. Moral code, like natural law, a bunch of things so that they take up on their own and take off like a baby bird, and they don't see me as an enemy anymore. And then if they're really evil, then I'll capture them, send them to a quarantine realm, and then I'll monitor their graduation so that they get through a process of becoming whole. And they eventually, you know, see me as not an enemy, because I don't like revenge seekers. But yeah, that's what I do. And it's very nice because eventually after a while you learn that no one's too far gone, and every being has a purpose, and every, like, they were not just a demon before. Like most of these spirits aren't just born demons. They become them through trauma and entanglement. And I like that you individuated demons from devils, because I also read that too, as like one of these ancient overpowered species. But yeah, there's a lot, but go ahead and continue.
No, that was wonderful, and I appreciate that profoundly. Honestly, Sean Bond's experiences have been profound and intense. And he did bring up an ancient aspect of my personality. What he is referencing is, of course, that which is within myself, aside from my genes, which is, of course, Tavush Melek, which is the peacock angel. And that was the result of the Night of the Broken Circle. And John Bond might be familiar with that. If you are, sir, I'll ask you to recite what you know. Do you remember?
You were like doing document destruction, and these satanic guys did a pentagram circle to get like night vision, and they made it wrong to where the pentagram was open, and then you felt the demon overtake the whole base and attach to you, or whatever angel you want to talk about. Was it pissed off? I would be.
Understand that.
Attaching to.
Go on. I'm sorry. Go on.
No, sorry.
No. By all means, continue.
It seems like you made friends with it too, right?
That's so cute. No, thank you, Sean. No, you remember quite a bit to contextualize that for everyone, because that probably sounded that's like, this is what happens when you get like fragments of something that, and it just comes out as really psychedelic, and people just say, wow, that's they got the colors, but they're not quite sure if the colors are part of a painting or not. So I'll put that into within the frame to reframe what Sean Bond remembers, which I'm impressed. He's very familiar with the story and knows quite a bit. Basically, when I was working at night with document destruction in the incinerator at the Presidio Military Base. And by the way, the entire story is available on the video titled Satan's Crusaders, which is on my YouTube channel. You just go to the Douglas Dietrich YouTube channel, and you will be able to hear the story. And so just briefly, what happened was many officers who were members of Michael Aquino's coven decided that they were going to play with magic. And they had so much experience with Michael Aquino. They felt very confident, hubris, incredible hubris. By that, I mean arrogance, stupidity. And of course, there's only so much blood you can shed in terms of casting a spell, because there's not real, either that or you bleed out and you die, right? So you want to have enough blood left in yourself so that it's like, basically the general rule is, it's like you're making a donation at a blood drive. If you're contributing your own blood to a spell, it helps to have more of you, not just for the psychic connection all of you have and the energy you can focus, but also because each one of you can donate a pint of blood. And, if there's 12 or 13 of you, it's as if you drained a full human being and drained him dry for an act of sacrifice. So they were so arrogant in their overconfidence, so intoxicated, not just on alcohol, but their own overconfidence, that they decided they were going to go for one of the mother beings of them all, the peacock angel, the earth angel, the angel of earth. So to understand that there's an entire people whose lives are focused on the worship of the peacock angel from birth to death. And these are an ethnic group, his people, the Yazidi. And the Yazidi are in Iraq. So understand, this was one of the reasons for the invasion of Iraq. This was to ultimately exterminate the Yazidi people. In terms of the Yazidi people, everyone in the Southwest Asia, when Americans call the Middle East, understands them to be devil worshippers, the worshippers of what Muslims feel to be Satan himself. And again, this is a more watered down or two-dimensional mythology that has been subsumed into a major world religion. So in terms of Christianity, they had their own political reasons for turning gods into devils. understand that the original god of the Europeans, who were pagan, the original god of the Europeans, whether they were the descendants of the modern day, or rather postmodern Wiccans or witches, or the descendants of the postmodern heathen or neo-pagans, the original Europeans worshipped the horned god. And the horned god of the Black Forest, of the Germanic and Teutonic peoples, whom the Romans never conquered, whom the Romans could only go so far into Germania. And when they encountered the Germani tribes, the Roman legions were defeated. This defeat was profound. They later on tried to avenge their defeat and expand it into Barbaria, or the Germanic regions of Europa, but they only got so far. And put Germany in perspective for people, modern day Germany, think of a nation that's at the direct center of Europe, the true center of Europe, the heart of Europe, and it is divided in a sense into four. It's divided into four in the sense vaguely reminiscent of the Allied division of Europe in, or Germania, Germany, into four quarters after World War II. It's divided by history. And in terms of one aspect of history that people would be more familiar with, that would be the aspect of history of Germany divided by between East and West. That East and West division between what was formerly the German Democratic Republic, or Communist East Germany, and the Federal Republic of Germany, or West Germany, that Germany had the same division. They simply divided it along the same line as the division between the Christian Empire of Charlemagne, of the Holy Roman Empire, and that which was not Christianized. That was the original division of Germany, East and West. Charlemagne was the original founding father of the European dynasties. And Charlemagne's descent was rationalized as a kingship. He held what was called the divine right of kings. And people hear that term and it's meaningless to people today. What does that mean? The divine right of kings. It's basically not simply a man saying force majeure, which means rule by force. It means that he has come to rule over you because he is godly. Now, that doesn't mean he's just a Christian or a believer in God. It means, via the Merovingian bloodline, he is a direct descendant of Christ himself. So when Christ actually married Mary Magdalene, had a child, and this child was the father of kings in Europe, the kings of Europe were making their claim to divine right of kingship and married amongst each other to keep their bloodlines pure, because their own belief was that they were descendants of the Godhead, of Christ. In other words, descendants of God. This means that they are like Heraclesian in nature. Hercules was half human, half divine, the son of a human woman.
When I track his DNA,
yeah,
his DNA got around a lot.
Yeah, well, Hercules, yeah, was by that you're talking about how he spread his own seed around quite a bit, yes.
Well, like, not just him, but like his closest descendants, yeah, they had a bunch. At least what I track back, yeah, but. Don't let me interrupt you, but yeah, I read a lot of demigod DNA lineages, and it's really fun because there's like authority in a mystery school within a lot of empowering stuff, and like a direct line of communication, and usually sometimes they'll know about the deities will know about you when you're born, so it's like pretty interesting.
Yeah, no, what's important about that is there is far more documentary evidence of Hercules than there is of Jesus Christ. There were far more people speaking of him when he was alive than people spraketh of the Christ when he was among us. Heracles was quite real, and he was half human, half divine, as was the Christ. So in that sense, these lineages are divine. So when the kings were making their claim, and the first among them as a European, identifying with that peninsulars, that super peninsular subcontinent, Europe's not really a continent, it is a subcontinent of Eurasia, but it's super peninsular, meaning it is a peninsula with its own peninsulas. The Europeans were, before they were Europeans, were basically pagan tribes, particularly dominated by the Germanics. And Germany was divided in half by Charlemagne, who Christianized the western half. The other example predating that, that most people are unfamiliar with, was the division between North and South. Most people, of course, understand that Germany is predominantly Protestant. And this is what made Adolf Hitler so unusual, was because he was Roman Catholic, and that's because he was Austrian. And where was it that the German people of Austria became divided from the German people of Germany itself? Well, that's a kind of more nuanced division. Basically, Austrians are German hillbillies. And they were able to start their own empire, which was very Roman Catholic, and go south. Basically, what they had was considered at the time an Asian empire. Don't forget the Ottoman Empire of the Turks thrust deep into Europe. So every inch of land the Austrians won from the Turks was basically Europeanizing Asian territory. So when it came to the other division, that's subtle, but no less traumatic, the German form of intergenerational trauma that many indigenous Americans or Black Americans suffer from, there's a division that the Romans created, the Rome that they conquered into Bavaria, into the southern areas of Germany, was walled off from the rest of free Germany by the Limes Wall. That Limes Wall was no less dividing than Hadrian's Wall in England. Though people know of Hadrian's Wall, most nobody knows of the Limes Wall. But that which was below the Limes Wall in Germany became Roman Catholic, and that which was above the Limes Wall became Protestant. So you have this division between Christian and pagan, Protestant and Catholic, in Germania being divided into those four quarters culturally. And the original god of the German peoples was the horned god, the Ororc of the Black Forest. And this was Wotan. And Woden, which became known in the Norse culture as Odin, Woden was originally as much animal as he was human, kind of a Greek type of satyr kind of perception. Cloven hooves and the great stag antlers that were a sign of his virility. And this horned god of the Black Forest, when the Roman Catholic Church conquered much of Europe, understand it was a process that took 1,000 years. The original Christ was roaming among us in year one. We start the calendar based on his appearing among us. The Christian calendar starts with year one. And it wasn't until the year 1000 AD that the last European country, Scandinavian Denmark, converted to Christianity. It took 1,000 years for Europe to become Christendom. And that was the original identity that they held before they thought of themselves as European. And until that period of time, during that 1,000 years, the church was demonizing Wotan, the god of the Black Forest. They used his image to project their Christian concept of a devil. Of course, the very word Satan comes from Sethen, the original god of the desert of Egypt, the god of plagues and pestilential foreigners and darkness, blood, and war, the god who fought with Horus for Cairo. Cairo, the capital of Egypt, simply means place of battle. That was the great battle between Horus and Sethen, where Sethen was defeated and expelled. That was the original Satan. Yet Sethen, the original god that was this jackal-headed, diabolic entity, suddenly was Roman Catholicized in image kind of like Disneyfying something, and they changed his physical manifestation, his visualization concept. They reconceptualized him as Votan, the god of the Black Forest, this satyrical, as in satyr, this goat cloven hooved entity with the stag antlers, the very picture of virility and fertility. They said that's the devil, and of course he's hung like a horse, and then that's sinful too because that's hypersexualized. So all of that is where your European image of the devil comes from. Get rid of that. That's not your enemy. So in that sense, when you think of this diabolicization of this entity to propagandize on behalf of a religious church, and the rise of the church was coincident with the decline of magic. Magic was rife among the pagans, and the practice of magic declined and went underground and became the purview of the witches, whom the church then hunted down in a gynocide, a female genocide, a genocide of female practitioners of the craft. All of this is needs to be put into perspective so that you better understand your cosmology. So when it comes to this divine right of kingship, where the kings were coming from, how your European culture was born, this division of Germany into the four quarters, and your better understanding of history, your ability to contextualize it, so to understand that when it comes to sacred symbols such as the Hakenkreuz, the Hooked Cross, the swastika, that was the original cross that Constantine of the Roman Empire saw in the heavens when he received the voice of God that told him, under this sign, conquer. That was the original Christian cross. When Constantine Christianized the Roman Empire, created Byzantium, the Eastern Roman Empire, it was the swastika that was the symbol of the Roman legions. It was the Hakenkreuz, the Hooked Cross. That is your original Christian cross. That is your ward against evil, the ward against the anti-gods. And that was, of course, the warrior culture of the Romans that spread Christianity. Christianity was spread by war. So it is a warrior religion. Understand that if you truly want to be a Christian. And understand that you cannot be a true Christian unless you understand it as a warrior religion. So with that being stated, I'll tell you the truth, I really forget my original train of thought where I was trying to explain, you know, the kind of quartering of Germany, a crucifixion of that nation into four quarters, the difference between the Merovingian bloodline, the divine right of kings. We were talking about the genetic bloodlines. We were talking about, you can help me out here, Sean Bond, and help me free associate my way back on track. But you can start by just telling us your own impressions of what I said and what it reminds you of, and that'll probably help.
Oh yeah, I love. I watched a bunch of your interviews on the deep secret history of, and the cult of the Nazis, and I went. One of the your information helped inspire me when we went to Germany and visited. Is it Wardenschaft Tower or whatever? It's the one with the black sun in the bottom, and the guy did a bunch of rituals there. We went there and help because it seemed to be on a big ley line and a place of power, and we helped because I also get contacted by Odin. He sends a bunch of like ravens and crows and stuff when he like gives me messages. It's pretty nice. Realm travel is one of my other fun things I like to activate with people, and a lot of people have like different species from the realm, the nine primary realms they talk about. There's way more Earth has. She's like a really magnificent creator of realms, but also the other ones, other planets make their realms, and they like to share them and branch them off off of each other, and they can bilocate onto each other and then share and have like portal bleave over in travel between them. It's pretty interesting when like some of the realms are like in destruction, or like I read a bunch of things in Sirius went through the realms of Sirius A, and B went through a bunch of destruction, and then they were adopting a bunch of species there, and then some of those species they adopted were highly targeted, and then a bunch of multidimensional predators followed them and then started doing destructions, and then they brought them here, and a lot of the DNA that we have, you know, like, I also know about your concept of a lot of the ETs being origined here, which I agree, because I see a lot of time travel, and a lot of them want to get in the beginning of the game here. But also I go into, like, there's some species that are older than this universe in concept. And Earth is also older, and so is your a lot. Most people I read, human, are older than this universe, but in spirit, not.
There we are. I remember my train of thought now. Thank you. You can go on if you wish.
Thank you. I'm glad you remember. I loved you going into the anti-gods versus the Norse gods, and I wanted to go to Germany to empower that. I also found out there's a pyramid in Germany dedicated towards Hela, and there's some misinterpretations of history with her, because she seems to be a nicer god in the original iterations of her deity structure, and like it goes along with like a word Holly and some other an earth deity, and she was like worshipped and stuff, and it was a nice pyramid. I went to some star forts and some other stuff, but so I also agree with you on the anti-god stuff, which I'd love to talk more on, because they're the ones that are trying to stop us right now, so might as well expose them. I'll team up with you for protection in this, for those in the audience. So this is what I read as well with that. I read a whole bunch of dark sorcerers try to do rituals to open up portals. Most of the ones that are successful are usually through getting authority from authority holders on this end of the realm and in whatever side they're trying to open up. I mostly have seen the ones that are open up now all around the earth connecting to hell realms. And they're like bleeding over as a way to for some of the demons to like get through. And I'm not like against demons, like what you're per going se. To. Yeah, I see them as a necessary
evil.
Person I'd rather have here than that. But they also get kind of like incurred and sometimes whispered into their ear, and division is sowed. And so I want to branch the sides of light and dark, and it's like darkness isn't evil, but it is much easier manipulated into evil, because it is not as likely to master moral code and the natural law. But if it does, it can, and it become like positive darkness. It's like a unicycle on a tightrope walk while dodging gale force winds, but you can do it, and it's wonderful if they do, because then you're very empowered, and balancing light and dark is a wonderful spectrum. Evil seems to be perpetuating in like a monkey wrench and trying to pit us all light and dark against each other in a unnecessary way, instead of like ever expanding evolution that like challenges each other, like chess players on the board to like intensify growth beyond, if we were not in some if we were boring like in the heaven realms, but not to put them down, but like, yeah, I agree with you on that. they're mostly for like healing, and if you want to make an amazing place and a VIP club and like make creations, and if you want to generate super natural abilities and you don't want it to get fucked with, that's where you go. And then they try to flow a river of effect into the other realms to help them grow, but in a safe space. So it's like that safe spacey
yes
thing.
I like it.
But yeah, the real game is being here, because they don't have as much effect as if you're here. And it's immensely growing process if you're able to change or heal yourself in a human body here. You can achieve a greater level of love than anywhere. Well, this is why I read one of the biggest purposes for being in a human body in this realm is, like, we have all this genetic potential in an emotional body to experience a new level of love that's never been experienced before, as beyond any potential of any species. Most of us has never even gotten close to it, but we have the potential. And it, like, love expands into every ability. So it's pretty powerful to change everything.
And yeah, thank you. Bless you. And that's beautiful as always, Sean. Thank you for sharing that. So when it came to certain aspects of what we were talking about, Sean was bringing up the Velvetshire Castle. And of course, that is Vevelsburg. And in terms of Vevelsburg Castle of the SS, the Schutzstaffel, Heinrich Himmler's castle, where he, of course, had his own round table of the Knights of Black Camelot. These were, of course, the order of the Schwarzen Corps, the Black Corps, the knights consecrated by Adolf Hitler himself. And Vevelsburg Castle was where Michael Aquino went in 1982 and 83 to conduct a ritual overnight from October 19th on my birthday eve day into October 20th on my actual birthday. He did this so that he could not only, in his objective, bind myself, but also try to prevent the original old gods, the elder gods, the Norse gods, from returning into this realm, instead empowering his anti-gods. Michael Aquino was anti-Nazi because he was antithetical to the swastika, the Hakenkreuz, and all that holds the anti-gods at bay. In terms of the entire purpose of this kind of demonization of certain gods, understand that this is the way in which churches control and ultimately subdue or suppress the religion which they are replacing. That's what happened with Tibetan Buddhism. The original gods of Tibet were not Buddhist. They were not Buddhistic at all. They were Bon of the Bon religion, the original Mongolian religion. The religion of the Mongols was Bon. And so I actually had the honor of meeting and dealing with certain Mongols in my lifetime. And they were still practicing the Bon religion. And that's spelled B-O-N. People can look that up. And it is what the Tibetans, Buddhists, violently suppress and have demonized. So when you take a look at Tibetan Buddhist art and you see those demons, those are really ancient gods of Bon that have been demonized by the Tibetan Church of the Dalai Lama. So they practice their own suppression of a religion, and then in turn are suppressed by the Chinese communists. There's something karmic in that, but we won't go too deep into that irony. That being said, when it comes to the original gods that get suppressed and Vevelsburg Castle and what Michael Aquino was doing, this is what brings us back to...
Did you celebrate when he died?
I'm sorry? Oh, celebrate when he died. You know, that's, youth. You had to ask. First off, I'll continue with what I'm going to say. I'll put it this way. There, it was like barely a blip because his cult still functions in so many ways, and he is effectively still alive for all intents and purposes. For those of you who don't understand, Michael Aquino, and remind me to get back to the Peacock Angel. This is what I was trying to say with the comparison of Wotan and the demonization of a god. The Peacock Angel is a god that is demonized, so they're therefore perceived to be Satan himself by the major world religion of Islam. So in terms of, we'll get back to that, but just a little thing about Michael Aquino here. He established the Temple of Set. He originally converted to Satanism. Now, this was, I was born in the year 1966. In that year, 1966, on June 6th, 1966, was when Star Trek was released as a syndicated franchise series in Canada. It was released in Canada before it was released in the United States. Most people don't know that. And that was on June 6, 1966. That's important because Gene Roddenberry was a big influence in my life personally, had actually spoken with me telephonically with some extended conversations because he had a close connection with the Presidio Military Base Library. And he, of course, had created his character Spock independently, but I very much relate to the character because Spock is, of course, the character which originally Gene Roddenberry was trying to portray as an allegory for basically China, or rather free China. And there's even in one of the original episodes where Captain Kirk and Spock go back in time, that was the Gateway at the Edge of Forever or something like that was the name of that episode. And it also stars that famous British actress of Jewish descent. I can't remember her name now, but she played in Dynasty years later. My father had a crush on her. But in terms of her being in that episode and all that, Captain Kirk does say that trying to cover up for Spock's alienness, he says he's Chinese. He's trying to tell the police he's Chinese. But the reality is, for those who don't know, Spock's Vulcan lineage, most people do know this, was related to the Romulans. They're genetically indistinct. They're ethnically the same, but they're divided by politics. And the Romulans were meant to represent communist China, and the Vulcans were meant to represent free China. And they were supposed to be the original thrust of the entire series, that the main adversary was supposed to be the Romulans, because it was the Vulcan intervention for humanity that helped humanity progress beyond the barbarism it had descended into after atomic warfare, and recover a civilization to the point where it reached the stars, all through the Vulcan intervention. So the Vulcans basically save humanity, and they have their religion or their philosophy of logic called Kolinar, that was basically based off Confucianism, which is the state religion of Taiwan, the nation in which I was born. So this is all part of Gene Roddenberry's own World War II experience, when he was a bomber in the Pacific and had one time been ordered to bomb Taiwan, the island on which I was born. And for those of you who don't know, don't take my word for it, look it up yourself. You can find that Taiwan, an island almost the size of Japan itself, was known even in World War II as an unsinkable aircraft carrier. The majority of Japanese air power was merging out of Taiwan. That was their major aero base. And yet the Americans throughout World War II, for all intents and purposes, never bombed Taiwan. The reason why was the men who were sent to bomb Taiwan suffered what they said was hallucinations or delusions that rendered them unfit for combat. Basically, the men claimed that they saw a woman in the sky catching their bombs. Therefore, very few of the bombs that were dropped even reached the ground of Taiwan. This woman was the guardian of Taiwan, Matsu, the goddess of the sea. Her protection of Taiwan was absolute. All of that continues through today. Gene Roddenberry saw Matsu. He saw her catching the bombs his crew was dropping. He was one of the pilots, or the pilot, of the bomber crew that was attempting to bomb Taiwan. One of the few attempts. All of them were considered failures, and the majority of the men were institutionalized. Gene Roddenberry escaped institutionalization by saying he didn't see her when all the other men claimed they did, and so he was rendered still fit for combat. That's how he basically came through the war with his reputation intact. But he had seen something that changed his life, and that's why he created the character Spock, because he knew the spirit of the Taiwanese people, the Free Chinese, and disambiguated them from the communists on the mainland via the Romulans and the Vulcans. And he felt the Taiwanese would someday save America, and therefore portrayed the Vulcans as saving humanity. This is something important, and of course, when it comes to Vevelsburg Castle and Aquino's death, let's just put it this way. Around that time, 1966, that I was born, aside from Star Trek airing as well, Michael Aquino within, well, first, the man who started the first Church of Satan, the mages, Anton Zandor LaVey, a man of Jewish descent, decided he was going to take the philosophy of Ayn Rand, who herself was a Russian Jewess. And Ayn Rand was trying to create an atheistic capitalism that would be able to defeat atheistic communism. Now, understand that, again, communism itself sources from Karl Marx, whose real name, and don't take my word for it, you can look this up yourself, was Moses Mordecai Levi. And so he was also someone who had the rabbi is also a name, by the way. It's not just a position. He also had the name of rabbi that was inserted as a fourth name at some point. But with Karl Marx changing his name for the sake of marketing, which sounds rather anti-communist, but that's how he got the idea out. Geez, you okay there, Sean?
Yeah, I'm if I do this, this is mostly because something's trying to stop us from talking about something, and I'm like, okay, I have to track down exactly what they want me to not talk about and then talk about it, but don't mind me.
By the way, just to reassure you, it does indicate, we've got the red button up, it says Sean is recording the call, so we're recording, just so everybody knows, and we were concerned about that earlier. But with the rabbi Moses Mordecai Levi, Karl Marx creating communism as an ideology, and Ayn Rand, whose family was devastated financially and economically by communism, emigrating to the United States and creating objectivism, which is atheistic capitalism, that gets rid of all guilt, all sense of ethics, all sense of anything good or decent. She was creating what she thought was a ruthless capitalism that could beat communism because it got rid of a belief in God. So it was the Jewish individual named Anton Zandor LaVey who took that philosophy and rendered it theological in nature. He combined it with magic and created modern Satanism. And he founded the first Church of Satan. But understand that the Magus Anton Zandor LaVey, in taking the logical step from communism to objectivism to Satanism, he also was very much protesting against the fact that churches were free of social responsibility in the sense that churches in America are not taxed. So the Magus Anton Zandor LaVey was a proud taxpayer. He made certain that his church was recognized as a church, but nevertheless paid taxes. That being said, the first person who converted to Satanism that was really famous was Michael Aquino. In terms of, well, you know, that's unfair. That's not true, really. Jane Mansfield was a Satanist. Sammy Davis Jr. was a Satanist. These were all people who converted to Anton Zandor LaVey's church, the first Church of Satan in San Francisco. But, you know, Michael Aquino, he was the first one who really took it beyond just objectivist magic. And he said, I want to make something really serious with this. Here's the difference. The Magus Anton Zandor LaVey said Satanism is basically atheistic. Like Buddhism. For those of you who don't know Buddhism is not a religion originally, it's a philosophy. The original Buddha was a warrior of the Aryan caste of India, and he was a combat veteran who suffered from severe post-traumatic stress disorder. And as a man who had spent his life as a warrior killing, the great Buddha himself suffered a multitude of assassination attempts until one of them finally succeeded in killing him. He actually was assassinated. So the great Buddha, the original Buddha, was telling people to give up a belief in the Vedic Hindu gods. He was advocating a peace without gods. This was originally an atheistic philosophy. It became religionized as it progressed throughout Asia. And by the time it reached the Far East, Buddha himself was a god. And then it was a formal religion. And then you believed in the Buddha as the god. And the other Buddhas were also gods. So sometimes men attain an apotheosis, meaning godhood, after death, like Caesar did. So when it comes to what I'm saying about Major Santon Szandor LaVey, he was saying Satanism was like Buddhism originally, an atheistic philosophical practice, that you are practicing Satanism by believing in your own ability to attain godhood. There is no God and there is no Satan. Satan rather is a tulpa, basically a meme, a kind of thematic by which you render godhood within yourself by becoming Satan, becoming God. This is his philosophy. And Michael Aquino said, no, I want a theistic Satanism in which Satan is outside of me and someone I can pray to and bargain with. And so he formed the schismatic Temple of Seth, and the Temple of Seth being based on the original Satan of the ancient Egyptians. So when Michael Aquino did this, he also established pylons, as he called them, in England. These are branch churches. That England was the easiest because of Aleister Crowley and the tradition of the Hellfire Club in England, and the fact that they had once ruled a good part of the world and the seas based on their satanic empire. And they also took a nation and turned it into four quarters. They divided India into four by growing the Great Hedge of India. For those of you who don't know, the English live in this horrible climate where it's very hard to grow anything, and yet they've become primary hedge cultivators. And the English hedgerows, when taken and transplanted in subtropical India, or rather fully tropical India, they basically mutate and become enormous. They become giant bramble bushes that are effectively impassable. For those of you who find this hard to believe, take a look at the Americans trying to invade France in World War II. They encountered, and you can look this up yourself, what they called hedgerow hell, where General Erwin Rommel had ordered all of the troops prior D-Day to prepare in-depth defense. And the in-depth defense that the troops carried out was hollowing out hedgerows and basically placing machine gun nests within hedgerows. So they were perfectly camouflaged and firing out from hedgerows, and that and other booby traps. It was very similar to Vietnam. The Americans were chewed to pieces. They lost far more men in depth in France amongst the hedgerows than they ever did at D-Day. And this is why they developed tanks with these giant pitchfork assemblies. You can look that up. And their Shermans used these to uproot hedgerows. They were just using their tanks to uproot these hedgerows. Now, that's in Europe. By the time you get down to India, these hedgerows grow to the size of walls. They are far taller than people, and they mutate into mutathorn bramble bushes that simply overrun the environment. So the British generated a great wall of India based on hedgerows that divided it into four quarters. They crucified the subcontinent, and therefore they could decide who got to eat, who got the food, who got deprived of it. This made it far easier to control the population and starve out an entire quarter of the subcontinent whenever they had to suppress rebellion. All of this ultimately killed millions and millions of people. Over the years of the Raj, 100 million Asian Indians died because of controlled British starvation in each of these quarters. And all of the sacrifice fed the Hellfire Club, which ran England. So they had a long tradition of Satanism, and their Satanism was taken advantage of by Michael Aquino, who established pylons of the Temple of Set in England. And all of this was something that was the reason why J.K. Rowling, who wrote Harry Potter, is a member of the Temple of Set, an acolyte of Michael Aquino. So Michael Aquino ultimately moved to England. He lived in Scotland. He lived in a castle in Scotland for years. And he personally was in communication with J.K. Rowling, and J.K. Rowling, who wrote Harry Potter. That is simply a perversion of the original Asian Indian Vedic name, Hari, as in Hare Krishna, Putar. Hari Putar means the son of God. So Harry Potter is very real in its occult, magical formulary, in the sense that J.K. Rowling's got it straight from Michael Aquino. He was the occult advisor and consultant for Hari Putar, the son of God. So in her book, she purposefully honors Michael Aquino through the character of Voldemort. And Voldemort, of course, when he dies, subdivides his soul into seven or eight entities to maintain his existence in the material realm. This is exactly what Michael Aquino has done. So Michael Aquino is still very much alive. He's simply inhabiting other bodies. This is what's called a Horcrux in the Hari Putar, the Son of God novels, the Harry Potter novels. And this Horcrux is a very real magical practice. So when Michael Aquino died, he didn't die at all. So there was no celebration on my part, because, as I said, what's there to celebrate? Hence the role of the eyes. I hope that puts it in context now, my attitude. And as we turn back towards the Yazidi people, the demonization of Tavush Malyek, understand that Tavush Malyek, the peacock angel, Lucifer, is an ancient god that the divinity created to lord over the earth itself. He is a fell angel. He fell from heaven because of his pride. He would not bow towards man. When Lucifer, the bringer of light, the angel of light, would not bow towards man, and he fell to earth in his pride, he was essentially made the lord of the earth. But the only way he could reign as lord of the earth was to have his own people. And he created his own humans. If God can do it, so can I. The people he created were the Yazidi people. The Yazidi people are the people of the peacock angel. Therefore, if someone finds out about the Yazidi people and says, I'm impressed by the peacock angel, I'm overwhelmed by his beauty, he has every right to be the proudest being on earth, and you wish to join, it doesn't work like that. You can't convert to the Luciferian religion of the Yazidi people. You have to be born into it. With myself, it was different. There are exceptions to every rule. And the exception was based on my possession by the peacock angel because of a group of arrogant drunkards who decided that they were going to play with magic and were so intoxicated with what they had already learned that they felt that they could handle summoning the Peacock Angel himself. Now understand, our man Sean Bond asked, was he pissed? Because I would be pissed. Understand this. They're always pissed. Everything that's summoned is pissed. This is something that you as a human being must learn to understand. You don't know how lucky you are. As a human being, the only summonings you can ever get are from a court. And I know that can be bad. And you may never want to get those summonings. And that can be stressful, and that's its own problem. But compared to that, that's nothing compared to how you would feel if you suddenly were plucked out from your dimension and suddenly found yourself bound in a circle in some idiot's living room or garage or some abandoned basement or barracks or bunker, and they're asking you to do something for them. How would you feel to be plucked out of wherever you were at and then somebody wants something from you? There is nothing on earth that would probably piss you off more. This is why you're bound. This is why whatever is summoned has to be bound, because whatever is summoned is going to be royally pissed. But as a human, you will never suffer that. You are one of the only entities in the cosmos that is immune to that horror. And for that, you can thank the gods for your incarnation as a mere human being. Everything else in terms of vibratory levels that are just a bit into the other world, just a bit between the veil that divides this world from theirs, is summonable. And people summon them and piss them off. So when you conduct a summoning, there has to be the binding. And of course, you want to contain that which you're summoning as if it were nuclear energy. Understand that what you're doing when you're operating a nuclear power plant, you've got this engine of immense power that you're containing, because if that breaks loose, you're fucked, and everything around you is fucked. That's what happens when you summon an entity of any power. Well, of any worthy power, unless you're like doing something completely stupid and you're summoning imps or, you know, cosmic mosquitoes and shit, which is what most people wind up summoning because they're idiots and they don't know what they're doing and they're just playing with magic. And you get a kid and they're doing the Dungeons and Dragons bullshit and they're just like playing around. This is usually what comes at them. And they're lucky that it's just that. And this is because they're not sacrificing a human being, or let alone a worthy human being. They're just like maybe killing a cat or something. That's bad. Don't do that. Or they're killing rats or something. And, you know, that's even if they get that far. But what these men did was they took their own blood, each one of them a pint, and there were 12 of them. And each one of them took a pint and contributed it to the cause. And they drew a blood circle to contain their summoning of the Peacock Angel, Tavush Meliek. And so they decided that they wanted to be able to see in the dark as a predator of the night, and so that they could test out these new silencers. There were some brand spanking new silencers that were made for automatic weapons for the military by Department of Defense contract. For those of you who don't know, back in the bad old days, and it's still the case today in many cases, silencers were a one-shot deal. It was basically you had a silencer and one bullet goes through it, and that basically blows all the baffles inside the silencer, so you get one shot, and it's usually after that you throw away the silencer. And you might have a series of silencers if you're trying to fire several shots, but you know, you can imagine the problem of screwing that on. There's still no such thing as a silencer for shotguns until recently. Someone finally designed a silencer for a shotgun, but I believe, again, it's one use and disposable. In the old days, trying to silence a shotgun, they would make something out of paper mache, and it was good for only one shot. But when it comes to shotguns for an automatic weapon, that's extremely advanced, and in those days, didn't exist until there was this Department of Defense contract. It existed after that, but until that point, they had some of the first of these things. They wanted to test them out, and they wanted to do it at night. So they decided, lo, let's be able to see in the dark. Let's summon the Peacock Angel himself to give us this ability. So when they summoned him, I was working the incinerator, and that's when the world around me changed and the world inside me changed. The incinerator is incredibly hot, you can imagine. And of course, you're sweating, you're grimy, and you don't want to go near the flames other than as close as you can get to shove in the documents that you're working with, the crates, etc. I began to realize I wasn't feeling any heat, even though the incinerator was on full blast. I really felt cold. Suddenly, I felt very cold. The cold that I felt was the cold you feel when you get a blood transfusion from a frozen plasma bag that's just been defrosted, and you get the cold blood coming in you, and it hurts like a bitch. It is burning in its coldness. It is excruciatingly painful. I felt like that through my entire body, that cold burn. And I felt no longer able to empathize. Probably the most painful thing of all was the hole in my soul where I could no longer, like our man Sean Bond there with his cat, if you feel that warmth of that cat, you respond to it with a human warmth. You respond to it with a human empathy. You sense and you respond. If that cat had jumped on my shoulders at that time, I would have felt none of its warmth, and I would have had none of the response of empathy that is evoked by that warmth. Am I coherent? You understand what I'm saying? All of that was gone.
Stuff with the demon, it's like a, for me it was like I don't know, in like Harry Potter you reference as an example, the Dementors and the like ice coming in and forming and getting me to forget everything around me to, that would empower me. It felt like a void and like a fire inside me was being hushed out. My ability to create love and all that was being hushed out, and then eventually like overwhelm and like torturous pain. But yeah, my cat would just freak out and hiss at me at the time.
Yes, thank you. Thank you.
You still did you get your empathy back?
I got the majority of it back. As I said, if people want the full story, you can see it at Satan's Crusaders on my own YouTube channel, Douglas Dietrich YouTube channel. But what happened was something was forever taken from me. It could have been a happy memory. It could have been basically the fact that we had a something that made me more fully capable of communing with other humans. Something was forever taken. There is always that gap, that hole in my heart. But at the same time, something was emplaced in its place, and that was an element of the Peacock Angel that will forever be there. This is why when I visited Iraq, and this was in 1988, in 1988, I spent my summer vacation in the first Gulf War. For those of you who don't get it, Americans have no concept of fucking history. All they think of is what's American is history. And so they use the terms Gulf War I and Gulf War II, and that's bullshit. The Operation Desert Storm, which I participated in, was Gulf War fucking II. It was not the first Gulf War. The first Gulf War was the Iran-Iraq conflict that lasted 8 fucking years. So the original Gulf War was something that I was a part of in its last year, the Iran-Iraq conflict, as a propagandist. And that was because the Iraqis were recruiting commercial illustrators to conduct a propaganda campaign for them so that they could appeal to the West and have the West understand that they were fighting on behalf of the West, that they were saving the West's ass from the fundamentalist Iranians who wanted to overrun all of Southwest Asia. And at that time, Saddam Hussein was the great defender of the West. He wanted the world to understand this. I never met him personally, but I was flown by the Iraqis through the Iraqi consulate in San Francisco on contract during my summer vacation, and helped at that point to bring an end, in a sense, to the Gulf conflict at that time, Gulf War I. I later participated in Operation Desert Storm, Gulf War II, and of course, the Gulf War that was the invasion of Iraq itself, that was the third Gulf War, that's Gulf War III. So if you want to look at it as a purely American experience, you would say Bush War I and Bush War II, Operation Desert Storm being the war of Bush the Senior, and the invasion of Iraq being the war of Bush the Junior, Bush War I and Bush War II, if you want to disambiguate it from a purely Amerocentric perspective. But such being said, when I was in Iraq, aside from so much else that I saw there, I visited the Yazidi people, the worshippers of Satan, as the Muslims view them. So to the Muslims, the peacock angel is Satan, is because he's Lucifer. But that's a conflation of two very separate entities. And the reality that Lucifer is the fell angel, the earth angel, the lord of this realm, and God is the lord of the heavens, but Lucifer rules the earth. His people are the Yazidi, and the Satan is the fell angel who fell further than Lucifer, fell further than most into the pit. So when you come to the concept of Lucifer, the peacock angel, understand that he is, in a very real sense, everyone's God, kind of, is he's the God of this earth. And earth, just so people understand it, is from the Germanic goddess Erde. Erde was the mother of Thor, and she was the daughter of Nott, the daughter of night. She was the mother of Donar, the original German name for what became anglicized as Thor. So Earth is the only planet in our solar system named after a non-Greco-Roman deity. All other planets in our solar system are named after Greco-Roman deities. If we were to use that same Latinization of Greek gods that is used to name the rest of the planets, such as Venus instead of Aphrodite, Mars instead of Ares, Mercury instead of Hermes, then Earth would be named Tellus, T-E-L-L-U-S, and everyone on Earth would be not an Earthling, but a Tellurian. But we don't use that, because Earth is Midgard. It is man's home, Mannheim, and Earth is therefore the only planet in the solar system named after a Germanic goddess, the Earth Titaness, rather than a Greco-Roman divinity, as all the other planets are. Very important. So in that sense, we're all Earthlings. When it comes to Mother Earth and the peacock angel, his people are the Yazidi. But when I showed up among them, visiting them while I was propagandizing for Saddam Hussein in the first Gulf War, the Yazidi people accepted me as one of their own because they sensed Tavush Malyek, the peacock angel, in myself. They even offered me one of their daughters' hand in marriage, which I did not take. She was legally underage. Not that that would have stopped me, but all of that being said, it was just, I was not ready for marriage. Aside from that, it would have entailed so many other responsibilities. The reason why was they could foresee their own tribulations in the future, that with the fall of Saddam Hussein, that their problems were just beginning. They could foresee his fall, and they could foresee ultimately ISIS. And in ISIS was created, by the way, for those of you who don't know, Michael Aquino wrote the book Mind War. And when he wrote the book Mind War, about psychological warfare, the man who wrote the preface to that book, the man who wrote the preface to it was also its secret co-author, was General Paul Villele, who was a co-religionist, a fellow Satanist of the Temple of Satan. And Paul Villele has gone on record to say, I created ISIS. General Paul Villele created ISIS specifically to exterminate the Yazidi people. And the logic was that if they killed the Yazidi people, exterminated the race of the peacock angel, Tavush Maliek, that he would lose his tether and all of Earth would be unbalanced and fall into chaos. All of this was their intent. And for those of you who don't understand the true evil of these worshippers of the Edomites, the anti-gods, the kings of Edom, then you don't understand the nature of what we're fighting. So Tavush Maliek, the peacock angel, Lucifer, the god of this world, is on your side. The Yazidi people must be protected at all costs. They have suffered enormously throughout their existence, one of the most persecuted peoples on earth. Their god is demonized into Shaitan, Satan, by the Muslims, in the sense that the Roman Catholic Church has demonized, satanized, Wotan, the god of the Black Forest of the original German peoples. So that's the track that I had lost, but I regained it thanks to our circuitous adventures together with Sean Bond. Tell you what, Sean, give me a short break. I'll suck some tea here while you take over for a bit and share some of your wisdom in regard to that with...
I'll take a break, too. I'll use the restroom and all that.
Okay, so, Joe, we'll stop recording for about how many minutes you want to give? 5, 10 minutes? How much?
Yeah, sure. 10 minutes is fine.
10 minutes? Yeah. Okay, so, all right. So let's give it a break for 10 minutes.
If we both get back, it's what...
Back is when we start again. Okay, yeah, well, it's 5:22 p.m. right now, so we'll be back about 5:30-ish, you know. Okay. About 8:30 your
time. Okay, everybody, welcome back. We just got interrupted. My internet went down right when we were talking about something big having to do with the anti-god. So we're going to totally hone in on anything doesn't want us to talk about. So good job with your strategy, buddy. Okay, so I was like, okay, the anti-verses seem to be like a lymphatic system where it's compressing them in the immune system, any viruses that invade the body concept for the multiverse from other multiverses that are invited is like, as what I read, it's a way to process them through those anti-verses before they are then able to invade the universes of light. And then go down to the invasion targets.
So your voice is kind of fading out to me. I can't hear you for some reason. Make certain your microphone.
No. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay.
It's low though.
Interesting. Okay.
Okay, better now.
Thank you. Okay, so then I also track back a bunch of these concept multiverses, ultraverses. I called another thing that's beyond those ultraversal bubbles because it has a different form of space physics that I call this the plane of authority because it runs through a bunch of powerful source spirits to go through, it's like a school, and to become management and authorities in particular topics such as divinity, safety, love, fortressing, offense, defense, all these kind of categories of concepts and experience. So there's all, and then those beings will sometimes form universes, because there's a lot of them that will be advanced in one particular concept and possibly a few others, but like will then also bring in immigration based on its rules. This universe that I found, and this in multiverse, is kind of like a melting pot universe, similar to the U.S., where it will take in all the multiverses. Its goal is to eventually take in all the multiverses. It started off making it more quarantined so that it could maintain order in the beginning, and then once the invasion started coming in, it had to flood that in and prepare for it. But it's working up to then bringing in the more darker things as an equation so that it can resolve everything to eventually peace or some form of unity or order in working with them all, because then that grows a bigger authority to affect everything else. So I do track back a bunch of these evil universes, or like pure evil, chaos evil, order evil, a lot of concepts of toxins, these things bleeding over that are similar to Stephen King's Mist, like in some of the things in the Antiverse. Not all of these beings in the Antiverse are like bad. They're more oriented to being top predators in their space. So their moral code is different in natural law, because it's like everywhere. But there are like I've seen some exchanges between the Antiverse and this one, like with you know, Satan, whatever you want to go into. Like I've seen a lot of predators claim to be Satan. It's like it's a continuous like Wizard of Oz thing where something wants to replace it and prevail this like unstoppable power, and a lot of them get like run through or destroyed, and then something replaces them. But a lot of like where you said Set, Ibis or whatever, some other apex predators of the past from different countries like will take up that title, and ones I've seen invading from the Antiverse also like to take that title when they're presenting themselves to other people, because that's the well-known term that like scares the shit out of people. There's I believe a remedy that Earth is trying to do to get the Machiavellian divide and conquer thing that's being put on the ones that are ultimately on our side for Earth back into unity against this ultimate evil that's not having any good purpose. Mm-hmm. What are your thoughts?
Oh, just thank you so much for that, and definitely appreciate it. I think that your experience has been so profound that you have a profound view of the multiverse, and your multiversal perspective is certainly appreciated. I do want people to understand that, of course, I work with the cosmology that pretty much has to deal with the universe that we're in, and I do believe that concentrating on some of these potential universes or parallel universes, it can, of course, distract us. It can serve as a distraction, and many people kind of lose themselves. They lose themselves in it, and it's something to just be aware of, that some places are just not meant for people to go into. What it does create, however, is a fascinating potential for understanding different developments that might have been historically or that might yet be historically. So we would, in the old think tank days, we'd consider this a kind of gaming. We'd game things out. Now, what's strange to me here is that, you know, when I'm putting the screens up and down, sometimes we're getting a glitch. I hope you're not getting that same effect, but otherwise
on my end, but like it's kind of going away every now and again. So they're trying, but see what they don't want you to talk about. I'm sure you have some intuition on that.
Yeah, and I think what they don't want us to get into too much is the vampires. Now, we came here to kind of talk about that. Our man has talked about the book, and what I will explain to people is how we got into kind of a conversation when our man Sean Bond got knocked off the internet. So just so everybody knows, this entire interview is going to be like stitched together when he's done with it, and maybe kind of broken up into parts and stitched together again, but however it works out, we covered so much basic ground, and I don't want us to get too far afield. And so when he brought me here tonight and we talk a bit about my background and we talk a bit about vampirism, you're not going to really understand what I'm saying about vampirism unless you get the book. So I do want to give everybody a bit of a background behind the book, but just basically buy the goddamn book and you'll be able to understand some of what I'm saying. And understand that it's only half a book. It's we had to get everything we could cobble together out as quickly as possible so that we could basically cement copyright on it. Which is something that I was always leery to do but by the way, you can take a look at that picture of me on the back of the book. The front is my mother, but in the back, I look horrible, more like Christopher Walken than myself. And that is because I was really worn to death. I'm sorry? Yeah.
This
yeah.
is your mom? Wow.
Yeah. And but I'm sorry?
That's a good picture.
Well, thank you. Yes, and when it comes to the a picture of myself on the back, that was after years of taking care of my parents in their decline, and that was my mother entered decline through a catastrophic brain injury, which would have killed any baseline human being. But of course, she was half vampire, half vampire, and I myself am a fourth vampire. Now, there's a technical term for that. Quite real, you can look it up yourself, called dampfire, meaning that somebody who's not a full-blooded vampire. The dampfire are anyone who is half or a quarter or further bled down, to use a pun, where their blood's watered down again just to be punished here, from true vampirism. But if you were a true vampire, almost certainly you would not be female. Well, certainly the Soviet studies into this matter concluded that the vampires were a purely male species because they are a parasitic species. And here we're talking about the sanguineous vampires are sanguivorous, meaning blood eaters. The sanguivores, true vampires that are eating blood, not some goddamn psychic vampire or some other kind of subtle variation, which people dignify by calling a vampire. But basically, vampires, dignified as they can be conceived to be, are still parasitic. And as a parasitic species, they're not functioning like a normal species, which is serving as a host. So, understand that in nature, the overwhelming majority of the gender bias really goes towards the feminine. We're not talking about social bias. Social bias in human society is obviously patriarchal at this point in history, and that is horrible, and it has its own horrific consequences. But when it comes to nature, nature is overwhelmingly matriarchal. And you take a look at anything from ant colonies to termitaries and the various social insects, all the way to the species that have no males and the females are reproducing by themselves, or to other variants of this, such as the seahorses, where the woman impregnate the men and force the men to carry, rather the men impregnate the woman, but the woman force the men to carry the babies to term. They force the men to take the baby and basically carry it in their belly and then give birth. The men suffer the birthing process. That's so seahorses are revolutionary in that sense, but at the same time, the matriarchal nature of nature itself. Some people would therefore make the argument that vampires are unnatural because they are strictly male. But again, this follows a kind of natural pattern here in the sense that as a parasitic species, they every once in a while will impregnate a human woman who will either give birth to a full-blown vampire, which will always be male, or a dampfire, like my mother, who can be female because she's only half vampire, and therefore can give birth to someone like myself who's only a fourth vampire. But when it comes to pure vampires, they're always men because men are better able to rape, men are better able to kill, men are better able to brutalize, men are better able to terrorize, men are just, force projection machines. And therefore, there's every reason that vampires would only be male. So there is a natural logic going on there. And every once in a while, by giving birth to dampfires, a female who is raped by them will therefore also kind of carry on the species' survival by producing someone who can act as a diplomat for them. However, mostly dampfires have been abused as vampire killers. For those of you who don't know, dampfires have always traditionally been viewed as being real, just as vampires are, and historically accepted as real and also historically accepted as the best vampire killers. So this was originally how Dracula's lineage started as knights of the Holy Roman Empire. They were vampire slayers, the original Dracula line. This has to do with the dampfire nature of their background. So when it comes to the dampfirism or being a dampfire, the last recorded, officially state-sponsored vampire slaying was conducted in Yugoslavia back when it was still Yugoslavia. It has since balkanized into much smaller nations, Serbia, Montenegro, Macedonia, Hrvatska, Croatia. All of these smaller nations were once part of a federative socialist Republic of Yugoslavia, and it was in that communist republic that a state-paid-for vampire slaying took place, conducted by a dampfire, someone who was half vampire. This was in the 1950s or 1970s. I'd have to look back through my notes, and it should be in the book. If it's not in the book, it's in the part that's missing from the book. So, just so people get that. And we'll get back to what it's like to be a vampire, in a sense, where I was talking to our man, Sean Bond, about that when we were offline. Here's the deal that you need to understand with the book. Basically, I was working with when I first came out as a public informant, 2000, and by the way, if you ever hear various cultists of the Kings of Edom, that are attacking my character, they say all kinds of bullshit about all kinds of crap. And what they really get mixed up is the chronology. And understand that I started appearing on Coast to Coast AM as caller back around the time my parents were still alive. So my father died 2007, my mother died 2011. So I was really starting to come out around 2007 and started appearing more and more on Coast to Coast AM as a caller, and got on Coast to Coast AM itself as a guest around 2011, 2012. So we're talking about that period of time when my mother died was the year of Fukushima Daiichi, same month, as a matter of fact, same week. So within that span of time, I was already a public informant. Now, by the time that my mother died and I became a public informant, fully outed as such, then, of course, Colonel Michael Aquino dispatched assets of his to try and maintain some kind of handle on me and tether me, keep me kind of under control. And so Lorian Ann Fenton was the first of those. And Lorian Ann Fenton wanted to take advantage of the fact that before I met her, before she was dispatched as an asset assigned to basically handle myself, maintain me under control, In the sense of preventing me from basically accessing the public to any great degree. And by the way, you might say, knowing this, why did you take her on as quote unquote a manageress? Understand, most of the people out there who don't deal with espionage, you don't realize that as a spy who comes in from the cold situation, you don't really have a choice. It's better that than having people constantly trying to kill you. It's better that than having to deal with so many other burdens. At any rate, it's almost impossible to do anything alone. So you need to almost team up with even an assigned handler to get something out there than doing it by yourself where you can't get anything out at all. So there's a, you may be turned into, at least for a time, controlled opposition, but otherwise you won't get anywhere. So I had to get started, get on some platform. In my case, it was Revolution Radio. I wouldn't have gotten that without Laurie Annette Fenton. So it was, there was all this that is the nuance of the situation. Now, when it comes to the some of the nuance of that situation, when I was working by myself, my mother's still alive, still taking care of her in her final days. I was involved as a public informant with an idiot, I think his name was John Michael Greer, I think, who ran a show called ShadowsInTheDarkRadio.com. He was loosely affiliated with Ripley's, believe it or not, and he purchased Mysteries Magazine. Now, the woman who had Mysteries Magazine ran it for years successfully. He purchased it and ran it to the ground in two issues. Basically, 2 to 3 issues, it was dead meat in the water. Its main readers as a pulp rag magazine, in other words, paper magazine, actual product, were prisoners and the military, and which is both kind of like the same audience. So he refused to do what I suggested, which was, look, you own the magazine. You can produce a special issue anytime you want. And I produced a very long article for him at his insistence, so he could publish it, and it never got published. So we decided to expand that into a book, but the article, he gave the stupid title because he wanted me to write about both vampires and zombies, neither of which are undead. That is an ancient superstition. Vampires are very much alive. Zombies are impacted in such a manner that you might think they're dead or reanimated, but they're technically alive. The undead is kind of a stupid term to apply to either case. And when I told him this, he said, well, it's a selling point because both of these had something to do with communism in terms of the exploitation of both of these conditions. So he called it the Red Undead. So this very long article I wrote called The Red Undead, at great exhaustion to myself, staying up several nights and losing sleep over days and days, he never used. So Laurie Annette Fenton said, let's hire a professional writer to turn it into a book. But of course, she didn't want to pay anybody. So somebody came forward and volunteered himself, named David John West. And David John West was a Mormon guy who ultimately used myself as a consultant in a short story that was the most popular short story in the anthology of short stories titled Space Eldritch, and Eldritch stories with a space theme. And so when I served as a consultant for that, the one thing I noticed was he didn't want to use one term that I said should be used. I said, if you're using this in your short story, he credits me in the anthology, by the way. I'm the last credit, which is the most important. People remember the first and the last. I'm the last guy he credits as a consultant. And everybody loves his short story. I always thought we should have written many more of them. But he and I never found the time to get together. And then somewhere along the line, he grew to hate me. But originally, we were very good friends, very intimate, shared quite a bit. And he never blamed me initially, at least consciously, for his wife's attempt to try and sleep with me. And he handled that very well and put his blame elsewhere. And ultimately, I guess all that soured. But the point was, for a period of time there, he volunteered to expand The Red Undead into a larger book format. But the problem was he was a fiction author, and he tried to make this into a novel type story. And as Sean Bond can tell you, he's got the book. This is a series of medical notes. You can't turn this into a goddamn novel. It's like taking Grey's Anatomy, the medical textbook, and trying to novelize it and add romance. It's just a stupid idea, and it doesn't work at all. He was trying to basically take the fact that I had encountered one of these artificially created female vampires, which the Soviet Union had created. It tried to create female vampires, and it did so by the most primitive method in the days before genetic engineering, through medical and surgical means, basically supermassive blood transfusions, killed most of the people that they worked with, and wound up finally succeeding with very few female vampires created artificially. And those that survived the process in mind and body, because understand, this isn't something like you just it's not something even as simple as, say, for instance, look at this. You know, a woman becomes pregnant and her body is built in such a way that it can accommodate that. But she changes. Her very bones begin to warp. What's inside her takes so much energy, the woman literally changes shape. So say the woman gets an abortion, and what that does is it takes that bodily rebalance and takes away the cause of that bodily rebalance, and she's not pregnant anymore. That alone warps again the physical nature of everything she's contending with. And so just as the postpartum blues delivering the baby creates suddenly the loss of what she had bonded with, carrying this being under her heart for 9 months, and she's left with this sense of loss and depression. You get that instantly with the abortion, and you get everything changing for men can never begin to even comprehend the horror of pregnancy, of eating for two people. It's a terror, like having a tapeworm that's devouring everything you're eating. Everything about that, if you were to suddenly become a vampire, and not even suddenly, these women who were made into such by the Soviet Union had to go through months and months and months of torture to transform. Think of something far beyond pregnancy. You're changing what you subsist off of. You're suddenly subsisting off of blood. Your entire body changes to accommodate that. You're no longer going to think the same way. All of the processes biochemically have changed. So you no longer think like a human being. You are now thinking like a non-human. You are thinking as someone who is beyond human. So basically, you are no longer part of the human link in the food chain. For all human beings, you all think that you're the apex predators because you have denuded the earth of entire species. But the reality is, you're not at the top at all. You're towards the middle. Human beings are at the same level, somewhere between an anchovy and a pig. You are something that eats far more vegetables than you eat meat. Now, granted, there's plenty of Americans who have done their best to warp that diet and eat as much meat as possible and almost never touch their vegetables. But the reality is, humanity as a whole is far more vegetarian than it is predatory in nature, subsisting off of meat. At the top of the food chain, apex predators are pure meat eaters. This is all they're going to eat, is other forms of life. So human beings are nowhere near that. In fact, if a human being were fed nothing but meat, they would die. They would die fairly quickly. It might take a few years, but you can't live like that. This is, hence, the balanced diet. So you are not like my mother. My mother was very close to an apex predator. My mother hunted people down and killed them and drained them of blood. She could do that. I am only a fourth vampire, not half. I cannot drain a person dry. My mother had the capacity physiologically to hold 12 liters of blood, that much blood from an adult male, in her belly, like she was suddenly pregnant, like a camel hump. She could carry that and sustain herself for weeks from an exsanguination, from draining someone dry. I do not have that capacity to imbibe that much blood. So when it comes to the human tropic level, your ability to subsist off of sustenance, if you were on a scale of 1 to 5, a primary producer would be a plant, and 5 would be the apex predator, a pure animal that eats so much off the food chain in terms of meat that it has few predators of its own. Between that, human beings are in there in the middle, 2.21 on average, basically, roughly equal to an anchovy or a pig. So all of you think differently because of it. When you suddenly become an apex predator, say the Soviets did to you what they did to so many of these women, that they tried to dispatch as agents for the Soviet state. You suddenly are thinking so radically differently that most of them went insane. They simply could not maintain the sense of balance between their new diet and anything that anchored them to humanity anymore. Since other human beings become food to you, then you can't relate to them. Do you understand what I'm saying? So since you can't relate to them, since they're like cattle, then your ability to even talk to them diminishes. So this is the issue to understand. People have romanticized vampires, and they think of them as some of the most elegant and erudite and well-read and sophisticated cosmopolitans around, urbane and seductive. And all of this is a product of the Dark Ages and the Black Plague. During the time of the Black Plague, vampirism became conflated with nobility because of the ignorance abounding at the time. And it was due to the fact that the nobility imbibed a lot of silver to ward off the Black Plague. Now, colloidal silver no longer does this. You can imbibe colloidal silver that's on the market, and unless you're imbibing toxic amounts of it, you should be fine if you're taking it at a controlled level responsibly. But it's an antibiotic. And in the old days, they used pure silver, silver coins, as an antibiotic. The metal would destroy many of the germs that were in the water. So what the nobility would do would be they would liquefy it through their alchemists into colloidal silver. And this was edible, potable. So when their alchemists did this during the Black Plague, the nobility would be drinking this on a daily basis and they would never get the plague. But at the same time, the effect would be to turn many of them blue. You can look up a case of a man who took too much colloidal silver and he turned blue. They called him Papa Smurf. There are also people, entire tribes, born with this condition. some morbidly inbred families in the Appalachian Mountains, for instance. And this is basically a kind of blood change, hence the term blue blood, affiliated with nobility. They called them blue bloods because many of them had turned literally blue. Now, to the peasantry, they looked dead. And the peasants began to wonder, why are so many millions of us dying? But the nobility has turned blue and they survive. They never die. And it was assumed the nobility was undead, that they were living off of the deaths of everyone else beneath them. And therefore, the peasantry began to affiliate the nobility with vampirism. This is how that concept developed of Count Dracula, of the Baron, who was the Strigoi type of vampire, the one, the Nosferatu. All of this became conflated in the public mind with the nobility also being evil, to the point where people thought, oh, nobility is evil, nobility is parasitic, we must get together with our pitchforks and torches and burn the castle down. This is what led to peasants' rebellions that had to be put down by the dynasties. But this is where the concept comes from of nobility, blue blood, and vampirism all conflated in the public mind into this idea of the erudite, educated vampire. Now, the only reason the original Vladislav Sepish, Dracula, fit into that stereotype was at the time that he was originally a vampire, vampire hunter. His father was half vampire. He was a fourth vampire. He was like me. But he suffered on the field of battle a near-death experience. And in his case, his clinically dying, as I did, triggered that recessive gene. And that triggering of that recessive gene enabled him to become far more hematophagic than he was before, and he was able to take blood as a essence of sustenance, which before that period in life, he had been unable to. Now, I have been clinically dead, so in that sense, I am arisen. In that sense, it was the same with Dracula, the original, who became Nosferatu Rex, the king of the undead. The reason why was because as someone who became vampiric, because of the recessive gene kicking in with the near-death experience, basically, he was undead. So again, conflation, confusion. Is a person who suffers a near-death experience undead? Of course not. They are as alive as you and I. And vampires are alive. They do what they can to mimic the dead, at times as a survival mechanism, like playing possum. And that was why they became conflated again with the undead. Also, they spread rabies, or have the potential to spread rabies. And as a result, you suddenly see many people who degenerated, and they thought of these people as being vampirized. This is what I go into in the book. And the problem was, when we were dealing with David John West, he tried to take my encounters with the female vampire in the Balkans when I was serving as a mercenary there. He tried to take that and romanticize it and turn it into a love story on which the rest of the narrative would pivot. And I said, I don't want to talk about it. It's a very private memory. Other than sharing the fact that it happened, I was not going to go into depth with it. And he therefore had nothing to work with. And he was fired from the project. So when he was fired from the project, 2 years later, we got it published, even to the point where it has an ISBN number. It's on Amazon. The Red Undead is on Amazon with an ISBN number, ISBN. You don't get that unless a book is published. It's like a social security number. You don't get one unless you survive the birth canal. Once you get out of the birthing process, and if you make it through that, you get a social security number. So it was published. He suddenly was recruited by one of my most active gang stalkers to claim it was never published. And that way, he telegraphed before he punched. He rattled before he struck. I knew, holy shit, he's going to take all my notes. He's going to publish them and claim they're his because he was given the credit of being the co-author on The Red Undead because we felt he had volunteered his time, he got fired, so we just left his name on as co-author, is kind of like, just as he had credited me for as a consult for his short story in the book, the anthology, Space Eldritch. So he was going to now run with it. So we had to get something out there immediately. And what we did was we cobbled all the notes we could together that we got out there immediately, but half the book is missing. So when you buy Vampirology, you get a lot of the physiology of the vampires, but none of the history, or not enough. All of that will be presented when we revise and expand the book, and we will do that, but enough of you have to buy this one. I swear to God, this was never intended as a marketing gimmick. Honest to God.
No, it's just, go for it.
Yeah, this is
As you're talking, we're getting a lot of hits in the spiritual unseen. A lot of, like, can you feel any pressures on your head while you're talking?
Oh, absolutely.
By the way, yeah. So I've been tracking it back. So, like, I love that you're brave in going into your family lineage origins. I'd love to hear more on that, guys. I also have tracked back quite a bit of DNA lineages in my mind. One, much older, though, so it's way watered down into sanguine. And when I was dealing with it, it seems there's some overarching predator that's monitoring the entire lineage, that's pretty high in awareness, that seems to be trying to puppet everything and orient the hunt lust. Your book goes into, I think it says, the vampire prime. It might have something to do with that. You said that the vampires can live 300 years plus. So I'm wondering if they've accumulated, like, more, you know, like how some people are like, oh, I want the best blood, or they are also expanding their tech into stealing more than just blood, but like the soul, the life force, the abilities, the part, soul, all these subtle energy parts and authority. I feel there's a predator that is trying to watch this, and I'm letting them know that we're not here to threaten the vampires. We both see them as a integral part of the
ecosystem. Like, the system, okay, of this let me put it this way. I it's important to qualify all of this. I appreciate what you're saying, and what you're talking about is, of course, basically a kind of consciousness, a metaconsciousness. A metaconsciousness that might act as a kind of ultimate hope for vampiric survival as an ethnos. And that is important. And I will get into that more in the future. I feel that that would be too abstract right now. But one of the things that is also important is that people understand, say, for instance, the when it comes to the vampiroid experience, and what we now have already articulated as to why the book is truncated the way it is. And again, the photograph on the back of the book of myself, looking so Christopher Walken-like. I mean, you could be honest about this, Sean Bond. You might say if that photograph looks like me at all, or just barely like me. But honestly, that's directly after almost over a decade without barely any blood that I ever drank. I refrained from drinking blood for all the while I was taking care of my parents, for the most part. Very seldom did I get an opportunity to drink any blood during the 11 years I was their care provider. And it shows I look very aged in that photograph. I look as if I've abused drugs for 10 years, which is basically a sleep deficit from 30 years, three different careers in which I barely slept at all compared to any regular human being. And then what happened was the stress of caring for them and their advocacy beyond anything any normal human being could have done. It would take hours to describe why. The end result was what you see there is a train wreck. And obviously, when I began drinking blood again and availing myself of that, I began to reverse that aging process. I feel look much younger now than I do in that photograph. I think Sean would probably agree. I don't know, but you know, your input on that is appreciated. Or maybe you could say it looks the same to me. I couldn't care less. It just is what it is. But you can see that my hair is much thinner. My hair is much thinner in that photograph than the hair I have today. Yes. And I feel look like shit. At any rate, then Peter Moon, of course, had to choose that photograph. But all that being said, the where we're at now, let me try and explain this to people. I can communicate with you because I'm only a fourth vampire. For somebody who's truly a full vampire, an apex predator, and yes, people have been killing vampires, slaying them is the term they use, for thousands of years, but then people have also hunted sharks. There are Polynesians whose very name in their language means shark hunter. But what happens when people overdo it? We've hunted sharks to the brink of extinction, and it's wiped out the ecosystem of the oceans. You have hunted vampires nearly to extinction now, and you're all paying the price in collateral damage in ways you can't even begin to comprehend. Vampires are some of the reason for your evolution. By forever terrorizing you from behind and prodding you to go ever forward, that's how you took the land away from the much more brutal humanoids, the hominids, that are known as the Yeti, the Agagwe, the Sasquatch. These hominids dominated the earth. And the only way you frail, pink, pale, vegetable-eating humans, you hairless apes, ever overwhelmed them was because we continually terrorized you from behind in the dark at night. Homo nocturnus, the night man. And that's why you had to leave your caves and leave the dark and go out and battle the brutes and overswarm them and ultimately take half the world away therefrom. So you owe us your very existence. You owe us the reason that you're civilized, because humanity suddenly developing cities, becoming social animals that were urban in nature, that is the equivalent of the honeybee breaking up its hive and forming separate family units instead of being a collective. That is so radical. What on earth ever provoked that? The terror of the vampire in the night. The hunter-gatherer could not survive that constant predation and had to gather in cities for security. This is what created the essence of the night watchman. That required a police force. All of this you owe to us. But the vampires, I speak for them because they cannot speak for themselves. The difference is, as apex predators, as all apex predators are, vampires are charismatic. They're not blue or deformed or undead. They're rather, imagine a Greek statue without an ounce of fat, an alabaster white. This is the typical vampiric complexion and physique. So these men that look like Greek gods, like classical Homeric heroes, they are at a state of development that requires no maturity. As I was saying to our man Sean Bond when we were offline, think about that time that you were pre-adolescent. There's a price to pay for the ability to reproduce. The moment a woman is able to bear a child, the moment a man is able to seed a child, You are on the clock. At that point, you begin to age, really age, to the point where your cells are no longer reproducing at a level where you're childlike. It's like an axolotl taken out of water and is no longer a water dog. It becomes a mud puppy, basically a salamander, and dies soon thereafter. The only way the axolotl can survive is forever being submerged in water and remaining forever fetal, basically a fetus, all their lives. And with the vampire, you're at that stage of cellular regeneration of a pre-adolescent. They mature only in the sense of being like an adult human, and this is what will happen with the wealthy elite when we begin using genetic engineering much more aggressively, and we enter an age of life extension, age repression, what they call the anti-agarthic stage of human development. This anti-agarthic stage is when those among us who are genetically tweaked basically have the injections required so that their cells begin to regenerate in the pre-adolescent sense. Reverse their aging, stop aging, basically become a human being who does not age. Once you are in that state, your mind changes and you are like a child who is pre-adolescent. You are no longer on the clock where you're reproducing while you yourself are dying. The moment you go into adolescent maturity and you're able to seed or bear that seed within your womb to fertility and into delivery, you're on that clock towards death. That's the price you pay for being able to seed new life. But when you're pre-adolescent, through life extension, anti-agarthic technology, you begin to think like that pre-adolescent again. Every moment of your day is the present moment. You no longer think on chronological time. You think in cosmological time. Just as a child, there's no sense of the past or the future in any great sense. Every moment is the present moment. You are always in the moment. The child doesn't relate to adults. Adults are the voice in the background, like a Charlie Brown cartoon. Wah, 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 wah. The child relates to other children. You relate to your peers. And you relate to the cartoons you see. You relate to very few things other than that which you grasp at the childlike level. But the one thing that you really relate to is that time is timeless. Everything takes forever. To a child, it's, are we there yet? Are we there yet? But when it comes to the vampire, that's where they're at. You're talking about someone who's never had to mature. They are aging at such a slow rate. They can live for 200 to 300 years. They are forever in the present moment. You are food to them. They have no ability to communicate or talk with you. It's like, imagine an extremely charismatic, autistic child in the body of a Greek god, alabaster white, perfect physique, and unable to communicate. Yet most people would not be afraid of him because he's so sexy, so attractive. They would be seduced by him. If he can't talk, most people wouldn't care because he looks so fuckable. That's your average vampire. They can't relate to each other like children do because they're competitors. They range like wolves with their own territory. They don't pack. That's completely antithetical to their nature. They're more like lone wolves, every one of them. So they will fight each other for territory, for the bleeding. So once you enter that state of mind, your relatives would no longer look like anything you relate to. So anything you fantasize about vampires, get rid of it. Think instead in terms of an autistic adult, extremely autistic adult along the further end of the autistic spectrum who is basically predatory and has enough of a hardiness where they can be homeless and not have the impact that homelessness has on a baseline human. They can sleep in cold warehouses, mausoleums, and crypts so as not to be bothered, and come out and basically attack humans and disappear back into the dark. These are people who have no need to relate to anyone. They simply appear, take what they want, and they leave. Usually, anyone who survives their attack will be left with a fake memory because their saliva implants a euphoric, the kind of tryptophan that you find in LSD and other ecstasy-type drugs, the dimethyltryptamine, the DMT. They, via their saliva, transfer that into your blood while they take yours. If you survive an attack without being exsanguinated, completely drained, your memories will be completely biochemically altered. You'll think you saw them turn into a mist or turn into a Voron, a raven. And that brings us back to the totemic animal of Odin, which often visits Sean Bond. That is the totemic animal of the Vanthyr. The blood-sucking bat is a creature of the New World. That's more totemic to the Aztecs and their blood sacrifices. The Eurasian Vanthyr, there was no such thing as blood-sucking vamps in the bat form anywhere in Eurasia. They're all frugivores, fruit bats. The real totemic animal of the vampiric ethnos is the Vrelskudalak, the Voron, the raven, that was the vulture of Europe. And in the massive battlefields of Europe, it was the ravens that would feast off the dead bodies through all the interminable wars and plagues. And some of them became mutated to the point where the dead human body was all they could feed off of. That's when they went from being a Voron or a raven to a Vrelskudalak, a true eater of the dead and an eater of living humans. These kinds of ravens became so gorged on human flesh, they grew, and they would sweep babies out of their cribs and devour them. This is the kind of totemic animal of the vampire of Europe, the raven. And this, of course, is like the vulture, that which brings the dead to the other world. That's why they're the messengers of Odin. Does that make sense? To the other side. So that true is the totemic animal of Dracul, the family Dracul, and the whole bloodline, the lineage thereof. When it comes to vampires, then, think of them as childlike adults, forever in a pre-adolescent state of development, no need to mature. Your suffering is funny to them, just like when a child looks at a cartoon and sees the Porky Pig or the Daffy Duck and they're hit with a hammer or a baseball bat and the stars come out and the child just laughs, ha ha, because the child has no concept of suffering. The child has no conscience. The child looks at the suffering of the cartoon characters falling off cliffs and blowing up and going through walls, and he says, ha, look at how funny that is. That's what you are to the vampire. The vampire laughs at your suffering. I'm not trying to take away any sympathy for them. Understand, the shark eats you too, without hating you. But if you're kind to the shark, you can pet the shark in the right circumstances, so long as there's not blood in the water. Think of that as how you would try to survive in the presence of a vampire. And in that sense, perhaps the vampire can be tamed. But this is not socialization. Just as a shark can never survive in any aquarium, because the shark must constantly move and never stop, and therefore as an apex predator can never survive in captivity, neither can the vampire. You cannot socialize them. So the closest analogy, and as all analogies, it has its limits, and it's a poor analogy, yet one of the few that rather fits. Think of the horror movie franchise Wrong Turn. Both these were deformed, toxic, industrial effluvia, toxic waste created mutants that were cannibals, but they had these human-like European relations who ultimately drew in victims for them, who could speak even with European accents and opened hotels so they could feed their family. That would be somewhat the role that I feel, not to lure you into a human version of a roach motel to feed you to vampires, but I act as their emissary only in the sense they can never speak for themselves. Literally cannot speak in any coherent form you would understand to any great degree. Like an autistic child limited in their ability to express, you would consider it an expressive asphasia. So when it comes to the role that I fill, it's to create an understanding for why they are to be preserved as you would the shark or the wolf or any apex predator. Why they must be preserved in that sense, and why you must never hate them for their killing any more than you would hate any other act of God. A tornado, a hurricane, an earthquake takes your loved one. Do you hate God? Do you hate all creation? Do you hate nature? Most people, no. Therefore, you can't hold it against a vampire taking your relation in that sense either. But people did. Hence, they abused people like myself, exploited them, vampire, to hunt vampire down. And the results, the consequences have been catastrophic. Overpopulation, much else that you're unaware of. The collateral damage has been unspeakable. So we must help the vampire survive. The first step in that is simply understanding them. You would do that by reading the book and enabling me to get a revised and expanded edition out where the history will then be fully explored and explained. That being said, the sanguivore vampire, understand that they are overwhelmingly Europoid. They are overwhelmingly Christian. Understand that when, yes, the all of these things become conflated and confused in a diabolic or demonic sense that the Edomites have taken advantage of. Think of what I said about the swastika, now perceived as a symbol of the ultimate evil, is your true ward against the anti-gods and the original Christian cross. Think as well that when it comes to the vampire, when you hear the term Edom that I have used, it simply means red, representing the red soil of the red lands that surrounded Israel at the time of the Canaanites and the Israeli conquest, the annihilation of that race when the Israelis stole their land and the Israelis were surrounded by hostile enemies, and the red lands to the south were known as Edom, red lands, red. Adam, the name of the first recognized man, fully recognized because he became cognizant of his humanity in a new sense. Adam was a farmer. He was white. He was Caucasian. He was in the Caucasus Mountains region, south thereof, where the very word Caucasian comes from. Adam was known as red. Adam, Edom, they're the same word, just in a different language. He was called red because white people are the only people whose blood can be seen in the face. This blood in the face is called a blush. When a white person blushes, they blush all over. It's a bodily flush. However, since most of the time you see them with clothes on, you see it only in the face. But in reality, their entire body turns red. Hence, Adam had this complexion. Hence, he was called red. Also, he worked the red soil, the red earth, and tilled it, hence was known as red as well. All of this is important because Adam, Edom, one is known as pure raw evil, the other known as the father of man. He was the father of man in this sense. He was not the first man in the biological sense. He was the first man in the conceptual sense, because Adam, working the farmland, had to have a concept of seasonal time. You had to know when to reap, when to sow. And when he sowed, he knew he had to keep track of the seasons in order to harvest. Thence, he became the first man with a concept of time, and he introduced the concept of time binding, the calendar. And for that reason, Adam damned us all to time binding. Hence, he was the first man. He was the first man who developed a sense of cognizance of time. And that's when we first developed a sense of mortality. With the hunter-gatherers who lived with the passage of time, moving their hunting grounds per the season, there really was no sense of time. A man died when he died. Most people died in their 20s. So when Adam developed the binding of time, we began to understand our mortality and our aging. And from that, he left the Garden of Eden. We left that garden of idyllic, Edenic existence outside of time, and we entered this trap of time that forever made us aware of our mortality. That's when we began to die, cognizant we were dying. And that, of course, is the change in all humanity, where we left that Garden of Eden in the Azerbaijan, up there in today's Azerbaijan and the northernmost region of Iran near Tabriz. All of that northernmost region of Iran, where Aryan man came from, the very name Iran is simply the word Aryan in Greek. Aryan transliterates into Iran in the Farsi language of Persian from the ancient Greek of Alexander the Great, who conquered that land. And so here you have the Caucasoid vampires who subsist off these humans, these farmers. And of course, when you think of Adam, his righteous third son, the righteous third son of Adam, not Cain or Abel, but the one who did as he was told, was named Seth. This didn't in no way, shape, or form makes him satanic. In fact, he was the first Christian. It was Adam who told him that man would someday be redeemed, that he had seen the vision of the Lamb in the Garden of Eden, and he sent his son Seth to Christianize the Chinese. His son Seth went into the East, and when he went into the East, he was one of the founding fathers of the Chinese culture by teaching them farming. He taught them farming, and the original keepers of this tradition were the Magi. You can read about them in the Revelation of the Magi, the Chinese mage kings out of the East who came from Jin, the land of China, all the way to Israel, which they invaded with a full army in their attempt to find the Christ. They are the people who baptized the Christ, who was originally just Jesus, son of Joseph, and they made him the Christ, which is a title. It is not a name, it is a title. The Christ means the anointed, and it's never awarded to anyone else before or since. So the Christ was anointed onto him. He had to have someone to baptize him to do that. It was the mage kings who did that. And there were 12 of them, not three. You can verify this by reading the Revelation of the Magi, which is translated from the Syriac and was written in Christ's time. It was excised from the Bible for political reasons by the church, which maintained the original copy. And that was translated by Brett Loiter, I believe his name is. No, not Brett Loiter. That's a friend of mine. Oh, God. Well, you look up the Revelation of the Magi, you'll find the author. And he translated it from the Syriac. I'm sorry?
I remember you went into this. It was very interesting, like bridging the East and the West and the origins of Christianity. Do you mind if I ask you some
Please.
Some things that I came up in questions that I didn't see in the book, and maybe in the new book you're gonna create? Who knows? And before I go into that, you did a good job in dispersing I don't see them as an enemy. That's connected to our DNA lineages, that it is trying to monitor the race of vampires and
or vampire.
Vampires.
Let me finish the one point, though. I do want people to understand that the Mage Kings in China were their vampire. So it was the vampire who baptized the Christ. That's why they were worshipped as Mage Kings in China. Go on.
Those vampires were intelligent.
They were intelligent because the Chinese were able to basically bring them criminals as sacrifices, a kind of human tithe. And they were therefore accommodated socially. And in that sense, it's not like true vampires are unintelligent. They're simply non-functional in a social sense. Rather, these vampires weren't very functional either. They were living a monastic lifestyle, isolated on the mountains, deep in meditation, receiving tithing from the society around them. They didn't need to interact with the society on any large scale. So their intelligence was more what the people interpreted as magical. It would be like people who respected autistic people and respected their talents and accommodated them, and did so without demanding that they socialize. In other words, the relationship that developed was far more mutually beneficial, and therefore not so much parasitic as it is in the West or in the rest of Eurasia. And in that sense, because of their power, their strength, their longevity, they were considered the Mage Kings. In a sense, many of them were probably Dampfire, more like my mother, half-breeds. And in that sense, they maintained the cloisters in these hermetically sealed monastic communities because they were able to take care of their relations who were not so socialized as they. Does that make sense? Do you understand what I'm saying? And please go on with your questions, that having been clarified.
Cool. I was just like, because I'm trying to see if based on what you're saying, so that there are magically oriented vampires. Wonderful. I also read into that. Confirm that with what I read before, that a lot of the vampires are like, I was using the word feral, kind of.
Yes.
Like where they're more predatory.
Yes.
And they don't really have the need for, you know, interacting with accumulated knowledge. I do, though, read that, like, there's possibly very somehow gained even greater life extension, older origins of the vampire that seem to have accumulated large amounts of power and greater intelligence than a normal one that you usually see. Whether, you know, I can't really easily confirm that other than there's something contacting us and that's concerned about the survival of vampires with our bringing out this information. That you've actually done fairly well in your explanation while we're dealing with that head stuff that was coming from it, to disarm its fear of what we'd be bringing out in influence of the population. And my thing is also like, these things are this species is needed in, you know, helping limit human expansion that's unnecessary, as well as they have a
Oh shit, he glitched. We glitched out, so we might he might have lost The net? Did you get knocked off the net? Are we still on?
No, I'm here. Do you hear me?
Yeah. Yeah.
Hello?
Yeah. Oh, I hear you.
Cool. Okay. Trust. Okay. Yeah. So there's a big drama that they're dealing with, and I think that one that's listening through our DNA lineage will be interested to hear the solution for it. I see a pathway for its evolution. You also used a interesting term, not quite in the way that I'm going to be using, but like you said, it's like their ascension process or whatever. I read if they align with Earth in a really well established way in purpose, where like predator hunting dark predators of our species.
Yes.
That's my mother manipulating humanity. Oh, nice. Yeah. They get rewards from Earth for doing that. If they don't go after just innocence, then they can evolve quite nicely. And like you, your book even went into this realm, Glacius, which I thought was interesting because I do read they have some realms tied to them, having to do with where the lineage of the concept came from before it got to this Earth realm. Can you go into a little bit of that? And then I'll keep in mind that this, if it's in a body, if it's a big overarching spirit that's looking over the DNA lineage, whatever it is, it's monitoring us. Thank you for being here and watching. Hey.
I would say that Glacius would be a good way to understand it would be kind of a vampiric concept of heaven. It's kind of like where the sun never rises and it's eternal night and it's generally cold and what they would consider kind of an idyllic Elysium. In a kind of happy hunting ground. It would be along those lines of the Native American Indians had the concept of the happy hunting ground, and in the kind of feral, as our man Sean Bond has used, the kind of state that the vampires exist in the present moment, Glacius is kind of their version of that. I think that's probably the most adequate parallel that is comprehensible to the human mind. One of the most important figures in history to help people understand vampirism is, of course, the historical Dracula. And it needs to be the character, the historical individual needs to be disambiguated from the literary character. But nevertheless, the literary character also shows us certain public perceptions or misperceptions of the historical Dracula. Understand this much that is important. The historical Dracula was originally Orthodox Christian, which means part of the Church of Byzantium, the Eastern Orthodox Rite Church, which utilizes the ancient Slavonic liturgy. And this church was the Church of Constantine. This was the original Byzantine Church of the Eastern Roman Empire. What happened was the Church of Roma of the Western Roman Empire, that was a product that emerged hundreds of years later. You could say it was the product of fraud and forgery, in that there was a forged letter, which then gave rise to the Western European concept of the papacy. And this is not to insult or assault or somehow discredit the Western Roman Church, but rather to put it in historical perspective, that was the reason for the schism and hostility between the two churches. So when the Church of Western Rome evolved, the Church of the Pope, what happened was the original cross of that church is the church of the cross of Saint Peter. As Saint Peter felt that he was unworthy of being crucified by the pagan Roman Empire in the manner that his God Jesus was, the Christ, so he asked to be crucified upside down. The Romans honored this request, and they crucified Saint Peter upside down, and Saint Peter's cross is the inverted cross. That is a legitimate Christian cross. The inverted cross can also represent the Christian sword of the military, the militarized church, the Militia Christi, the warrior Christ. And Saint Peter's inverted cross is why there's an inverted cross on the throne of the Pope. So the point is that Dracula grew up between these two worlds. His father, who was born into the Byzantine church, was nevertheless a knight of the Holy Roman Empire of Germania, the First Reich, which lasted almost 1,000 years. The First Reich was established by Charlemagne and lasted all the way through the Napoleonic Wars, when it was dissolved by Napoleon Bonaparte. And the First Reich of 1,000 years was the Holy Roman Empire of the German nation. And so you had the original Dracul, the father of Dracula, who was Romanian, but at the same time, a knight of the Greater German Reich. And under Emperor Sigismundus of Luxembourg, the emperor of the Holy Roman Empire, it was Dracul, the father of Dracula, who established the Order of the Dragon, the Knights of the Dragon, who were dedicated to slaying vampires and werewolves, the lycanthropes, that plagued Europe at the time. As a matter of fact, Emperor Sigismundus of Luxembourg declared it a law that if anyone denied the existence of werewolves in particular, they were such a danger, slaughtering thousands of people, that if anyone denied their existence, they would be burned at the stake. This was a problem that was so serious, Europe so plagued at that time by vampires and werewolves, that an order of knights was created to slay them. And Dracula was the son of the father who had established that order in the name of the First German Reich. And Dracula himself is literally, not literally or historically, but literally by the Irish house nigger, basically, because Bram Stoker was an Irishman who became a British citizen and then wound up serving the British nobility by producing novels. He was the medieval Dracula's, the historical Dracula's greatest publicist, but he was also someone who mythified him in what is generally considered a negative sense. And Bram Stoker, he understood the real historical Dracula. He actually was operating on the Romanian theme, and it mutated as he continued to write the book. So if you ever read the original novel written by Bram Stoker of Dracula, the original novel says that Dracula, his coffin, must forever have blessed or consecrated soil. In other words, he portrayed Dracula as a Christian. He said his soil in his coffin must be blessed, must be consecrated to help him maintain himself. That was his understanding from the real Romanian history. See, what happened was that the original Christian Dracula, Dracula himself, not his father, his father was assassinated. The original Dracula himself was someone who was considered the champion of Christ. He was someone who fought on behalf of Christendom against the Turks. He was a star crusader. And what happened was, in order to maintain Romania's defense, when he used up all of his own resources, all of his own financial ability to budget his conflicts, he had to turn to the Roman Catholic Church of the West to gain support from the Holy Roman Empire. So he converted from Byzantine Orthodoxy Christendom to Western Christendom, Roman Catholicism. At that moment, the church excommunicated him and declared, "You will never know no rest. You will be undead. You will never truly die. You will be a vampire." And when that was stated by the Byzantine Orthodox Church, when they excommunicated him and cursed him, the Roman Catholic Church took him on and said he was the champion of Christ. He was the hero of all of Europe, both East and West, at the time that he defeated the Turkish Empire, the most powerful force on earth, and saved Europe from conversion to Islam. Therefore, when the original Romanians talked about when Dracula appears, or when you encounter him, you make the sign of the cross, that's understood not as a ward, but as a pass. Because no Muslim or Jewish individual would ever make the sign of the cross. That is how Dracula would spare people who encountered him. That was the understanding of the true Christians. So understand, the majority of vampires have that Christian tradition, consider themselves doing the acts of God, the work of God, by culling humanity. And the original Dracula not only represents that, but literally, according to the literature of Bram Stoker, he romanticized him by saying that he attended the Romanian magical school of Sholomance. This is Satan's school, the school of the devil himself. And by adding that mystique, what Bram Stoker was doing was, he was saying that when Dracula died and reanimated as Nosferatu Rex, the king of all vampires, he retained that magical training from the devil's school of Sholomance in Romania. And therefore, he was not just a vampire, but a great sorcerer. Basically, someone similar to the Chinese sorcerer who was in the Three Kingdoms. Someone not just a general capable of tactics and strategy and operations, but capable of sorcery on the battlefield. A magical warrior, a warrior, a mage king, a magi, as unto the ancient Chinese mage kings. This is why Dracula is so special and so powerful as a symbol and as a historical figure. This is what helps us to better understand the concept of someone who can act as an emissary or an ambassador for that ethnos. So historically, what he did is what I do now. And this is what I'm here for, as, in a sense, the last Dracula. And that is something that is my very name, Dietrich, that I inherited from the man who raised and guided me, Dragon. Also, of course, can be said in the German to represent skeleton key. And of course, that being said, with all that we've covered tonight, I feel that we've done a great service. It must be close to, well, about, it must be late where you're, I'm ready to kind of check in myself, but sure, feel free to ask a few more questions. Feel free to ask any questions you want, and we'll see how long my wind stays up.
Sure, sure. And thank you so much. I really appreciate you. And thank you for coming on and sharing your truths. It helps a lot of people. Yeah, and I will definitely want to have you on. And put in the comments if you want to see him on, and share this video as much as possible, please. I got a lot of lists of stuff for later shows, but I'm just going to go into this because it is a little bit of keeps trying to grab our attention. Whatever you want to go into Vampiric Prime or, I think it seems what I'm tracking back is a little older than the Dracula that you're referencing. But, the things that can help it and any other vampire that, and you said they don't go on the internet,
No, no. It's like children don't really go on the internet, not naturally. Yeah, it's not really. It's not like we got to worry about vampires watching tonight's YouTube interview.
Yeah, yeah,
that was the question that was asked actually by Sean Bond when we were offline.
And if you are, then you know we're not your enemy. So yeah, I read that that the whole thing of them being reversed in mind to a childlike state seems to be being perpetuated by something attached to this lineage that is forcing its will on it. This manager spirit or whatever that's looking over the lineage that's listening to us right now, for a remedy, it's because it's asking, what we're doing, all those other questions it's asking me. But if you want to get rid of this thing, the thing they're dealing with seems to be in spirit a possession, a domination, forced entanglement, and a spiritual enslavement, as well as I recommend an evil death. There seems to be some evil spirit that's trying to dominate this lineage of races that's different than this race, that's trying to control it. So like another big apex predator that's like goes back to like evil multiverses and evil sources. Like if the Big Bang, the source with all these branches, each one is a source, your own source in that branch. There's ones that they like to dominate each other, and then it's like a big ball of that. So if they detach from it, because it seems to be making them fractured and low sovereign in their mind, in their control over themselves. Same thing with the werewolves, which I'm glad that you came up with the lycanthropy, because I wanted to ask about that, because I do read that as a DNA lineage that's passed down as well, mostly dormant. Yes. A lot of people have like resonance with it and an effect at full moon. So that'll be a fun show too. Like things trying to dominate that and then lower the sovereignty so there's less control and then make it so that it's a perpetual cycle of the same thing. And then they're all spreading themselves and gathering up blood, DNA tech, and parts and abilities and energy authority from their victims, and then passing that along down to the predator system that's overarching above it like a puppet master. Though I believe there's one central one that's like a legit like they earned it, they're the origin kind of thing, and they're meant to be overlooking it all. And then there's the illegitimate ones that are trying to dominate that one and subvert its will and then turn it into a more evil presence where I don't read that that's necessary. It's already contacting us about that, but like, yeah, we can go into shows about like how to solve that problem and make it so that, because like that seems like it would solve a lot of problems for the vampires if their intelligence was able to increase and as well as empathy in some way, not like totally, because that would also get in the way of them in
their predation. Yes.
But like to the point where, you know, I like that you went into that they have like their own spiritual belief and like why they're here and their divine purpose, and which is interesting. Yeah, if they go down that and they can keep evolving even more, because then there's a divine version of that. So
yes, I am very I'm just so glad that we made this happen, and we're going to make it happen again. And I love you dearly, brother Sean Bond. And I think you did a wonderful wrap up tonight. And with that wrap up, we certainly will speak again. You take care of yourself. Oh, I'm going to stay on with you. I mean, believe me. Go on.
Can you plug your information and how people can reach you?
Thank you. Thank you. You're so thoughtful. So basically, so people can reach me almost anywhere. I'm totally doxxed and exposed on the internet, but try douglasdietrich.com. www.douglasdietrich.com. Bless you, dear brother Sean Bond. Yeah, and he got it right this time before it was upside down. So he got it right.
Oh, yes, yeah.
Mephorology. Oh, yeah, mephorology, Douglas Dietrich. Thank you. Thank you. And bless you. And you're an angel. Thank you, Sean. So that's available on the internet through Amazon Books. Just look up Vampirology, the vampire research paper on Amazon. And enough of you buy copies of that, and we can revise and expand it and get the whole story out there, such as how Patient Zero was found, the connection to World War II, Operation Barbarossa, and of course the Nazi vampire units, the Nazi units of vampires. It's something that is important, and that side of the story needs to be told to a greater extent. If you want to avoid Amazon for any reason, you can order it directly from Skybooks USA. Or maybe you can't, I don't know. But try Amazon for Vampirology and try my website just for any other information. And at the website, douglasdietrich.com, you'll find my physical mailing address if you ever have a need for that. So anybody who wants to send a check or money order, because I do need money to pay the rent, you can send it to 1242 1242 Green Street, like the color green, San Francisco, California. And the zip code is 94109. That's 94109. And for those of you, and I do encourage this heavily, who want to sponsor me through PayPal or just provide a contribution, that's paypal.me/Douglas Dietrich. paypal.me/Douglas Dietrich. Any help you can provide will be appreciated. And of course, I have my own YouTube channel, the Douglas Dietrich YouTube channel. Look up Douglas Dietrich on YouTube, and you'll find that, probably along with all kinds of character assassination from the cultists of the anti-gods, the cults of chaos. Have discernment. I trust most of you have enough common sense where you can see the enemy for who they are. And when it comes to what I'm sharing with all of you now, none of this would be possible without Sean Bond. So bless him. And Sean Bond, you are the man. And we'll stay on call for a few moments after we end interview, of course. But I'll let him end the interview with his own summation now that I gave people what information that they need.
Thank you. Yeah, and I'm Sean Bond of the SAC League, and you can reach me at sacleague.com for in the services for like consultations and a bunch of video products. I make a bunch of videos on abilities to help people stabilize themselves, to heal, to overcome stresses and targeting, and accumulating more and more abilities as we seek to empower our collective and the collective humanoids and take back their power from the forces that wish to enslave us and hold us back from our greatest selves. And then I'm also on SAC League at YouTube and a bunch of other places you can contact me, like Facebook and other stuff. And yes, please donate to Douglas Dietrich. Deserves it, and for holding that much information in his head and retaining it, very valuable, walking library of a billion suns worth of knowledge. Lots of stuff to bring out in future shows. Show us your love. Tell us that what you think in the comments, and if you want to see more, please share. Share as much as possible. Get it out there. Try to get it out to vampires. If you can. I doubt it. But I don't know. Hopefully we get because they can't really understand. So whatever. Do you think they would sense you if they saw a picture of you? Like if somebody was a victim, like showed your YouTube video. No, don't eat me.
That's so cute. Actually, you know, when I try to emphasize what I did, because of course I don't want people to continually romanticize them, but at the same time, it's not necessarily as bad as I made it sound. Vampires are able to communicate to an extent, and enough to pass off in a crowd, so to speak, and maintain maybe a low-level functioning job in some, for at least a period of time. By that I mean months, maybe, or so that they can have a feeding ground or access to something. But it's like an autistic child. It's like there's only so much that can be done before people start noticing things. It's you know, not necessarily as feral as I made it sound, but not just, you know, you get the point. And anyhow, I love you dearly, Sean Bond, and I'm so proud of you for everything that you've done to make it this far in life through all of your challenges. And
I'm glad you exist and that you're still alive and going strong. Yeah, you do look younger, so I guess.
Thank you. And I guess whenever you're ready, we'll end the interview then.
Sure. Hope you guys have a good night, and see you in the next show.